into the day with the dawn ringing in my ears. Oh, well, I tune into my TV show. No better way, I gotta get myself into gear. Let's go. Oh, and I feel good today with my wake up in the morning espresso. I feel good today. It's my feel good breakfast show.
Good morning, you beautiful souls. Welcome to another edition. We are live opening up right here with S3 with this beautiful soul on my left hand.
Oh, well, thank you. A very good morning. This is your feel-good breakfast show, Expresso. And you know what? It is Wednesday. Like you said, it's the middle of the week. And we have something very exciting lined up for you. I'm talking about one of our favorites, the talented Majozi. He's joining us to really get our Wednesday going on the right note. I feel like that was a very gefrekte woo. Majozi deserves more. Let's give him that woo he deserves.
Majozi in the building.
And we still need to wake up.
And we've got something special because I'm going to be putting everybody through their paces. Why? Because after that epic performance that's happening, we're going to the movies and we're gearing up to the release of Fast and the Furious 9 this weekend. And we learn how to get ripped like John Cena himself. It's going to be a goodie.
I know. And I love how you're saying you're putting everyone through their paces. I'm doing fitness with you, so it's more me suffering to try and look like John Cena. I mean, you have to give me the female version of that.
No, I've seen your journey. You're good. You can stick it with the big boys. We got this.
Oh, well, listen, speaking of Fast and the Furious 9, we are very excited to announce that you need to stay tuned because you can win yourself some tickets to see that action-packed movie for yourself. Of course, we're also throwing some popcorn and some drinks in there, that whole fun combo. You can't go to the movies without the popcorn.
Yeah, of course you can't. And speaking of friends that we'd invite for some popcorn, I know two beautiful souls that would love to join us. Let's check in with them.
Besides the popcorn, we're already in the yogurt, but
yogurt!
That's really nice. It's Black Forest. It's really good, eh?
You went in. Now I know what kind of person 100%. You are in the movies. You eat your snacks way before the movie.
I get stuck in, eh? And then I start looking at your popcorn at about two-thirds of the way through the movie. I'm like,
This is why we'll never go to the movies together, G. But good morning to you, South Africa.
You're not going. I react well. I don't make a noise in the movies. And we're going to take you to the movies today because we love it. Fast and the Furious 9 is here. And we are loving the fact that it brings us not just one, but just about every action star imaginable. So we want to know from you guys this morning, if you could trust any celeb hardcore, I'm going to call it, to drive you out of date. Look at me. I look the least hardcore. I look like Jim Carrey.
You look
Carrey.
Excited. You look excited.
I look
excited.
Like
yeah.
Jim Carrey about to drive you into not... danger. That's just absolutely crazy. But if there is one actor, who would it be for you, do you think?
You know what? I'm going to say Raul de Mornay.
Really?
Because we did the cedar boat together and we had to do like lots of hills and he was a fighter, hey? Raul de Mornay came through and you know, I'll never hype him up on the show, but he what about
don't
you?
Laugh.
Who's your fighter?
I don't know, man. Probably Keanu Reeves. I've got a huge amount of respect for how much he trains for his fight movies, the John Wicks and The Matrix and things like that. He's turned himself into this expert martial artist, so probably him. But you can let us know, especially as Raul pointed out, if they took your dog, then definitely Keanu Reeves is the one to go for. But let us know on our social media pages. We'd love to hear from you. We are celebrating the Fast and the Furious 9 all throughout, and we're going to give you the chance to win and win big. But first, let's get into those official duties. The news headlines were so.
Thank you, Graham. I'll start with national headlines. President Cyril Ramaphosa yesterday said the government is considering imposing tighter lockdown restrictions, particularly in Gauteng, where the number of COVID-19 infections continues to rise dramatically. Meanwhile, private hospitals have suspended visits and some elective surgeries. Some 120,000 South Africans currently have COVID-19, according to the latest data from the National Institution for Communicable Diseases. More than 9,300 people have been admitted to hospitals, 6,200 are in private hospitals and 3,100 in public hospitals. And staying with local news, Gift of the Givers has given Kliprand in the Western Cape, where residents have been placed under quarantine following a COVID-19 outbreak, a much-needed helping hand. Most of the less than 70 households have someone who tested positive after the town was COVID-19 free for about 15 months. Three people have succumbed since the outbreak was first detected. Donations included food parcels, bottled water, hygiene packs, COVID-19 packs, which include sanitizers, 3-ply masks, reusable masks and soap, as well as medical packs, including vitamins, basic medication, blankets, and bulk food for a local soup kitchen. Now, moving beyond our own borders, Gabon has become one of the first African countries to receive payment for reducing carbon emissions by protecting its rainforests. The UN-backed Central African Forest Initiative has handed over 232 million rand, the first tranche of a multi-billion rand deal struck in 2019. Nearly 90% of Gabon is covered by forest, which captures more carbon than the country emits. Rainforests are vital for absorbing the globe's climate heating emissions, and Gabon has managed to reduce deforestation so to lower its carbon emissions year on year, and as a result, receive the money. Staying with news abroad, German Chancellor Angela Merkel has received a dose of Moderna as her second shot of coronavirus vaccine, having had Oxford AstraZeneca as her first. The 66-year-old leader was vaccinated a few days ago after receiving a dose of AstraZeneca in April. Experts believe mixed dosing of COVID vaccines could be a good idea, but it's too early to say for sure. After a slow start, Germany's vaccination rollout accelerated in recent weeks, with more than half of the country's population now having received their first dose. And now for some literary news from our closest northern neighbor. Zimbabwean writer and filmmaker Tsitsi Dangarembga has been awarded a prestigious German prize for a body of work that has made her a prominent African literary voice. Dangarembga, 62, is this year's winner of the Peace Prize of the German Book Trade, which is endowed with $29,700. That's some 424,000 rand. She will receive it in Frankfurt, Germany on October 24th. The judges said Dangarembga, who is the first black woman to win the prize, is, and I quote, not just one of her country's most important artists, but also a widely audible voice of Africa in contemporary literature. They also pointed to her commitment of promoting culture in her country and opening it up for women, and to her fight for rights and political change in Zimbabwe. Her works include the best-selling novel Nervous Conditions and its sequel, The Mournable Body. Last July, she was arrested and spent a night in detention for standing alongside a road in Zimbabwe's capital, Harare, holding a placard with the wording, "We want better, reform our institutions." She has this year also been awarded the Pen Pinter Prize and the Pen International Award for Freedom of Expression. Well, congratulations to her. That's where I leave your morning headlines. For now, let's take a first look at your sport with Graham.
Thanks so much. So let's start with cricket. India now lead New Zealand by 32 runs with 8 wickets remaining. That as they go into the reserve sixth day of the World Test Championship final at the Aegeus Bowl in Southampton today. Tim Southee picked up the wickets of both Indian openers as they finished on 64 for 2 in their second innings at stumps. So earlier, New Zealand turned their overnight result of 101 for 2 to 249 all out. And that World Test Championship final will continue from 11:30 a.m. SA time today. On to football. The 12th-minute header from a close range by Manchester City forward Raheem Sterling secured a 1-0 win for England against the Czech Republic, and that in turn confirmed their place in the Euro 2020 last 16. So England finish at the top of Group D with 7 points. And other results from last night, Croatia looked strong, recording a 3-1 victory over Scotland in Glasgow, thanks to goals by midfielders Nikola Vlasic, Luka Modric and Ivan Perisic. And there'll be 4 Euro 2020 fixtures today, and European champions Portugal will face world champions France in a must-see encounter at 9 p.m. And then staying on the topic, Wembley Stadium in London will now accommodate more than 60,000 spectators for the semi-finals and finals of Euro 2020. This has now been confirmed by the UK government. This increase will see the largest crowds gather for a sports event in the United Kingdom in more than 15 months. That Euro 2020 semi-final will take place on the 6th and 7th of July, with the final being played on the 11th. That's where we leave our sport for now. Let's take a look at what the weather has in store for today.
Thank you so much, Dee, for that sports update. Time to have a first look at the weather, but first, some news. A devastating mouse plague caused by a combination of ideal weather conditions is ravaging some parts of Australia, especially New South Wales. Ideal conditions for breeding and a bountiful harvest that followed destructive bushfires and a prolonged drought in the spring of 2020 have caused the worst mouse plague in many decades. Now, with plenty of grain to feed on and diminished populations of predators that perished during the drought, mice have flourished. Now, there have been reports of infestations at schools, hospitals, supermarkets, and family homes. A jail is being forced to relocate hundreds of inmates while it carries out cleaning and renovations. Now, more than 400 prisoners and 200 staff at the Wellington Correctional Centre will be moved to other facilities as the mice have caused extensive damage to prison infrastructure, including internal wiring and ceiling panels. The plague has hit farmers particularly hard, though, as they grapple with the cost of pest control and the destruction of crops. And then, of course, while we enjoy experiencing a sunrise from your part of South Africa, we do have some international viewers tuning in on both YouTube and the Africa channel in the USA. And this morning, we're keeping it down under as we report on the weather for the city of Wellington, a town located in the New South Wales region of Australia. Now, Wellington was the second European settlement west of the Blue Mountains, first established as a convict establishment in 1823. Wellington is the center of rich agricultural land. Now, while alfalfa and vegetables are grown on lands on the river, wheat, wool, lambs, and beef cattle are grown on surrounding pastures. The town acts as a commercial center for the surrounding district as well. The area, however, experiences a humid subtropical climate, and if you are in the region today, you can expect a mostly overcast day ahead with a mild maximum of 18 degrees Celsius being reached. And then coming back to our local viewer contributions, we received this absolutely beautiful sunrise photo from Anthea Langefeld from Ottery. Cape Town, you can expect the cold weather to continue today as a cold front continues to pass over the area. Do prepare for rain and a cool day ahead with a maximum of 15 degrees Celsius. Now, regular contributor as well, Fatah Khan from Richards Bay, also shared this serene image overlooking the ocean in the bay. Richards Bay, you can expect a pleasant day ahead with a maximum of 25 degrees Celsius being reached. And of course, we do encourage you, if you would like to share your sunrise photo with us, just head on over to the Expresso Facebook page, and who knows, you might get a feature here on your Feel Good Breakfast Show. Right now, though, it's time to have a first look at those temperatures. We start with you, Polokwane. Do expect a low of 6 today, peaking at 21. If you find yourself in Umbombela today, expect a range of 11 to 29. For you, Pretoria, it is a low of 7, peaking at 19. And then Johannesburg, following with a minimum of 6, peaking at 17. Mahikeng, 421, Klerksdorp, 320, and then Kimberley coming through with partly cloudy conditions ranging from 6 to 22. Bloemfontein, for you, it is 120, and then, of course, the Bay, Richards Bay, with a low of 11 and a high of 25. Pietermaritzburg, 725, and then South Africa's playground at Durban today ranges from 17 to 26. Mthatha, for you, it is 11.25, and in East London, partly cloudy conditions can be seen in your part of the country with a minimum of 14 and a maximum of 22. Craddock, however, coming through with a low of 7, peaking at 23, and then for you, Gqeberha, it is 10.19. George, for you, it is 10.18, and then the mother city, Cape Town, ranges from 10 to 15 today with a 59% chance of rain. However, Worcester, for you, it is 7.15, Sutherland, 1.12, and then last but definitely not least, Upington, ranges from 6 to 24 today. Of course, wherever you find yourself on this Wednesday, happy Wednesday to all of you.
Oh, I think it's safe to say, Donkey Jamie in Corsi, thank you. Bye-bye, Donkey. Now, you know what? When it comes to translations, it's more than just changing words from one language to another. It builds bridges between cultures. Now, imagine you could help build one of those bridges by translating just one word a day with Cadbury Dairy Milk to help co-author a collection of children's library African language storybooks. I think it's such a wonderful initiative, yeah. And it's such an easy way to get everyone involved.
Yeah, completely. We want to boost literacy across the board and get people inspired, and reading is how you do that. It's how you activate the imagination. So we've been attempting And I must say, quite badly to pronounce a lot of words in different languages, but we are committed to learning at the moment. And of course, our word of the day today, we're going to do our best to translate it as well, is kitten.
Kitten.
What is kitten in Afrikaans, sir?
A kaiki.
I was going to say a clean cat.
A katiki.
K-A-T-J-I-E-S. Kaiki.
Oh. Kaiki.
Okay. Oh, well, I added an S, a kaiki, so that's plural.
Okay. Clean kaiki. To catch all the mice Baba that we saw on the weather. That's what we need this morning. So we're going to attempt to translate this into vendor this morning and give you various iterations thereof. So we're going to start with kitten, which is kumange.
Kumange.
Kumange. Kumange.
All right, and that's vendor, right?
That's vendor.
And anything else? No,
all right, so now we're going to go through the full spectrum here. Cat is chimange.
Chimange, all right.
We're going to pluralize. Cats are zwimange.
Zwimange.
A lion or big cat. It's not a lion, but a big cat. Is a limange. You've got to say a little bit more meaning.
Limange.
And then, of course, the kumange is the kitten.
Okay, we're learning as we go. I love this, man. And I think it's such a perfect way to get educated and actually connect with our fellow South Africans at the same time. I mean, 11 different languages and cultures. Venda or Chivenda is a Bantu language and an official language of South Africa. So even more reason to learn this. And it's mainly spoken by the Venda people in the northern part of South Africa's Limpopo province, as well as by some Lemba people in Zimbabwe.
Very interesting.
It could connect our cultures. If we are saying it wrong, please correct us. Send us a video.
Please help us.
That's exactly why we do this, is so that we can learn along the way. But we want you to get thinking about just in its entirety what it means to be spoken to in your own language, but also to be able to read in your own language. And imagine children who have been denied access to this, how much it's going to mean for them to have an entire library in their own language.
That's right. So translate a word a day and help co-author a children's library in each language so that every story ends beautifully.
I love it. Ngajabula njalo.
That's a happy ending, man. We always want a happy ending. And you can go to cabri.co.za to start creating those books, hashtag in our own words.
It's my feel-good breakfast show. Welcome back. This is your feel-good breakfast show, Expresso on S3. Now, I don't know about you, but whenever it comes to, you know, trying to make a very important deadline, I think we all have felt that feeling before. Now, when that important deadline comes, there's always at night this moment where it seems like there's a pesky fairy that must be sending the tempting call of sleep to entice us to close our eyes and drift away blissfully.
Now this is the narrative being explored in the short animated film Sleep Mode, which created by third year students from the animation school. So let's take a look.
You know what that sound is? It's your alarm. It's absolute terror and panic. You fell asleep and you didn't finish your work. Oh no! Oh man, what a beautiful, beautiful animation. Well done to the animation school. Absolutely love this feature on a Wednesday morning. And it makes the perfect prelude to our discussion right now. School exams. There is just no running away from them. They are inescapable and they are in fact so important. They're a milestone, a marker that you get to put down to show how far you've come. And this morning, educational psychologist Dr. Sharon Aitken joins us to talk more about the importance of, yes, you guessed it, a good night's rest while studying for exams, as well as maybe some great tips for preparation for our exams. So we're speaking to the parents and we're speaking to the kids as well. Sharon, great to have you here in
person. It's lovely to be back.
How tired do you feel right now after watching that animation?
I'm very tired after watching that, I must say.
Oh, we had Majozi doing a sound check in the background, and I'm just sitting here like, oh my word. Absolutely beautiful stuff. But it really does kind of hit to the heart of the matter. It can be stressful entering into that exam period, especially if we feel unprepared, and you've got to kind of manage it on two fronts. Yes, you want to have done the body of work so that you are comfortable going into it, but in the moment, going into that kind of phase, you need to be rested, you need to be kind of looking after yourself. But let's start with the studying element of it. We know that it's not a one-size-fits-all. We all respond differently. I remember I responded visually, so I would draw like mind maps and kind of, but some kids can read it and take it in, some need to hear it. Why is it important to find your study style?
Well, as soon as you find your own study technique or what actually works for you, then the information, you're able to process it a lot more efficiently. And I think one of the areas that people often neglect to explore is actually movement while working. So particularly people who have difficulty concentrating when they sit still, you can get things like Pilates balls, wobble boards, standing desks, and then you can actually move around quite a bit when you're working. And I think that's an area to explore, because we tend to sit down a lot too much at the moment, you know, and then you do get sleepy and drowsy. So if they could explore that, there might be something worthwhile.
Aren't we? We've been directed as adults to explore that just from getting away from the sedentary lifestyle.
Exactly,
you know?
Yeah.
It's just healthier to do that. What is the optimal study time frame? How should we kind of work out our flow? Or is, again, that very different for every person?
It's different for every person and every subject. So if you find a subject difficult, then you can't concentrate for as long. But generally, I would say at high school, you should be able to concentrate for approximately 20 to 45 minutes comfortably. And then you need to take about a 5 to 10 minute break where you should be active. You should be getting up and moving around.
Exactly.
But most people can concentrate for 20 to 45 minutes. If it's a subject you enjoy, you might even be able to push it for an hour. But I really wouldn't want them to go further than that, because then the concentration plummets and then you're struggling down here at the bottom where you've got no concentration.
One word retention per
hour. Exactly.
Yeah.
And then they sit on their books and they try and force that information in, and it's just not going to work. So they're better off to take structured breaks.
I laugh rightfully because I'm going to play devil's advocate here, because I've kind of found the one job where it is all about cramming.
Yes.
And you have, you know, the adrenaline and the anxiety pushing you forward. I could only cram as a you know, and maybe not by choice, but by as a result of my circumstance. How do you feel about pulling an all-nighter, cramming? Because sometimes as an adult in life, you've got to do it. You've got to just pull a rabbit out of the hat. How do you feel about that as a...
Look, we've all done it.
Yeah.
We've all done it. It is something that inevitably is going to happen. You're going to get caught short-footed or something. It's not ideal. I mean, I'm going to use this moment now to punt what I really want to say about studying, and that is it actually starts on the first day back at school, preparation for exams. If you do a little bit every day, just a little bit, whatever little cupcake size of information you were fed that day in school, and you come home and you learn it off by heart, by the time you get to the exams, the majority of the work is done. Now, that would be the ideal. But we do inevitably pull all-nighters, and you usually absolutely exhausted the next day. So for those people who live on adrenaline and function well on adrenaline, they actually can perform quite nicely. But other kids or other people who suffer from anxiety, for them, it's not great.
Look, the flip side of that coin is by 11 o'clock in the morning, I am exhausted. So it's a balancing act. But I think this is great advice for parents and for learners as well. I love that. A cupcake size a day just to manage that workflow. And it starts with your first day back. But we're going to give you some tips if it's not your first day back and you've got to kind of get through the hard yards right now and are preparing for an exam, what you can do as a parent, and ultimately how important it is to get the right amount of sleep.
Nourish your skin with Ingram's Tissue Oil and Rich Body Care range for 48-hour rich moisture. Ingram's, your skin, your brave.
Welcome back. Thanks so much for locking back in. Earlier in the show, we spoke to educational psychologist and good friend on the show, Dr. Sharon Aitken, about overcoming procrastination and figuring out our own study style. And we're continuing that conversation with her right now. And I can't help but laugh at myself because I was probably the worst studier. But I knew this because my sister was probably the best.
Oh,
she was just immaculate, and she would smash, but she would sit terribly on her bed. But she could go for like 9 hours, and I think she got like 6 distinctions. Mm. She was just... And then there was me, and my poor mother had to deal with the two of us on either end of the spectrum. But I think where my mom got creative with me, and this is maybe where we can really help parents, was looking at all of those factors. So study environment, making sure that I was in the right kind of space. How do we go about setting? You mentioned just sitting and what we do with our hands or maybe standing. These are elements. How important is it to have the right environment to study in?
Look, that is pretty essential. But interestingly, it varies from person to person. So I've had worked with kids where going to sit in a restaurant or a cafe actually works, students. Other ones prefer sitting in the library, and others need the quiet of a bedroom. Some like to play music because it creates a white noise.
Yeah.
And then it cuts out the dogs barking and any other distractions
hardy
around
does.
Them.
Hardy
yes,
does.
Hardy does. And I think light is an important factor because if it's too bright, it creates like visual fatigue with the light reflecting off the paper. If it's too dark, then also you're getting visual fatigue.
Yeah.
And then it makes you think you've lost your concentration when actually it's just the lighting. Temperature is another big thing, particularly in winter. There's a tendency to close all the windows and make everything very warm, and that's going to make you quite drowsy. So there's actually quite a lot that you need to take into consideration.
You want to keep it fresh.
Yeah.
Studying in or out of bed. I can't think of anything more dangerous for me. I would have fallen asleep.
You know what? I went through my early uni years, varsity years, studying in bed. I was a bed studier, but I can tell you it's really not the best thing to do because it does make you feel sleepy, tired, you want to rest.
Think about your back, man. Yeah.
And you're in a bad physical position. Yeah, you're gonna tire.
How do we move away from cell phones? Now more than ever, we are connected, especially after the pandemic. It's how we've stayed connected. It's how we've studied. It's how we engage with the world. How do we, as a parent, justify and limit the amount of time that our kids are spending connected to their devices?
You don't justify it. You just say
you
have a limited amount of time. When you're doing your homework and you're studying, your phone is not to be in your bedroom. Then the kids will tell you, but I need my phone to study. Then you have to say to them, okay, you have a limited amount of time to access the information that you need on your phone, and then it goes off in the kitchen or somewhere charging, and it's not in the room with you. Because in my 50s, I cannot not look at my phone if it's next to me while I'm writing reports. So I don't see
how... It's a compulsion, yeah.
Yeah, and the kids are not developmentally ready to sort of manage themselves, so you have to be firm.
And with yourself as well, maybe. Just be firm. You've got to unplug, disconnect. How important are practice tests?
Very.
Why?
Very important. Because one of the things kids do is they work very hard to get the information into their head. But what they're actually going to be tested on is getting the information out.
Okay.
If you don't practice retrieving that information, you're going to sit in the exam and you're going to go, oops. I can't find the information in my head. Plus, there's going to be a specific style in which you need to answer depending on the subject. So you actually need to be going through those past papers. Unfortunately, a lot of schools no longer allow or give past papers to pupils. So obviously a matric, they're accessible on the internet. But in the lower grades, it's often not possible. But there are really good study guides that have mock questions that you can go through.
There are a lot of great platforms out there. YouTube, and many that are being offered now,
Exactly. So there's some wonderful... Yeah, as
just
you said, platforms.
Do a bit of investigating there. Sleep. It seems like a no-brainer, but it's often the first thing we sacrifice, and we've spoken about those kind of all-nighters looking at that amazing cartoon. How important on a physical level and an emotional level going into that day of the big test is sleep?
It's crucial. I was trying to think of a good metaphor on the way here today to explain it, but If you cram learning, you've basically run an ultra marathon. And if you don't get sleep, you go from an ultra marathon into a marathon. I mean, you are exhausted. You're not going to perform your best. So you need, ideally, before an exam, 8 to 10 hours of sleep.
Okay.
That would be ideal. I certainly wouldn't want to push it less than that. But I mean, if you've pulled an all-nighter, you've pulled an all-nighter, you must know you're going to go into the exam exhausted.
Yeah, and often there's another exam coming up in a
exactly.
few days after the fact, so you need to get back into that cycle.
And that's why you start from the beginning of the year.
You got it, with those cupcake size,
yes.
I love that. Even a popcorn kernel size.
Anything,
get it in
something.
There.
Oh,
yeah. Sharon, thank you so much. I love the fact that there are ways that we can approach this. Yes, we have spoken about being prepared as early as possible, but the main thing is, if you are having to go into those stressful periods, just make sure you start with getting a good night's rest, and the rest will probably fall into place.
Well, thank you, Graham. Well, other than sleep, what's the one thing we all wish we had more of?
Money.
That's right. And this morning, we are turning our attention to the youth of Mzansi to see if they have any solid financial advice to share with us. And we pose this question for you online. We ask you the question, fill in the blank. And the blank is, the motivation to blank helps me to save as much as I can.
I like it. The motivation to what exactly?
The motivation to give Luca a better life helps me to save as much as I can.
Oh, that's so easy. You have a child. Like, that's like...
That's easy. That is like, not easy. That
what else should you be doing?
What about you, mister?
I don't know. I love that. I don't have a child, so I don't have such a good answer. But I think just the motivation to create impact and make a change in my life and others.
That's very deep.
Yeah.
That's deep. Mine's a little bit more shallow. The motivation to live a healthy lifestyle helps me to save money. I don't order takeaways. My grocery list, I'm very specific with what I buy. There's zero wastage with what I buy. Meal prep's been incredible, but it's also been like, I don't spend money on takeaways.
I'm the healthy one. I should have said that.
now we all look bad. But let's see what everyone on social media had to say about this question, because we obviously posted online as well. So let's check it out.
Okay.
We have William saying, the motivation to budget helps me save as much money as I can. Joan Cameron also says, to live comfortably.
I like that.
There we go.
We have Daniel saying, good morning, Expresso team. Okay.
Good morning.
Good morning. Hey. Abraham says, the motivation to budget.
And that's a hard one. That is actually really hard, honestly.
What is a budget?
what is that?
Budget you speak of.
And then we also have Nazira that said, the motivation to budget also helps me save as much money as I can. Ooh, budget, the B word is coming through a lot here. Even Jamina says, the motivation to budget.
Ah.
Teach us your ways. What is this budget you're talking about? Because we need to understand. Nicole also says, the motivation to buy a house helps me save as much as I can.
Ooh, that's exciting.
You've got to say quite a bit
very
there.
Exciting. And then Mosh also says, the motivation to be my own boss helps me save as much as I can. Yes, if you want to be your own boss, you got to work. And then the motivation to budget. So a lot of people saying budget, that's coming.
The B word, the budget B word. And boss. I like
budget
that.
And boss.
Budget
Zanzi,
boss.
I think you know what's going on. I think you know what's important, of course. And I think you might be hungry too. And if you are for some financial advice and you want to take money seriously, then we're going to encourage you to visit the YouthX platform, and that's powered by Nedbank. So here you'll have the access to fantastic financial resources, as well as access to masterclasses with industry change makers who are dominating their field and have a lot to share. Now, it's all for free, and it's all waiting for you on the unlocked.me. So what are you waiting for? Let's get motivated, and let's go tackle all those goals.
Boss and budget.
Yeah.
Indulge your desires. Be swept away by the fragrance of descent. Take the plunge into impulsive spending until you find yourself deeper and deeper. Drowning in debt. In this world of temptation, do you want a bank that takes your money? Or a bank that takes your money seriously?
It's my Feel Good Breakfast Show.
Welcome back, everybody. This is your Feel Good Breakfast Show on S3. Let's talk about our little ones, because we know as parents, we only want what's best for our little ones, and the little details makes all the difference in the world. And that's exactly why when shopping for our munchkins, extra effort goes into choosing the perfect baby gear to ensure their safety. And mom and doctor, Dr. Cara Rinquist-Haynes, is here to discuss some of her preferred baby wear. Very good morning to you.
Hi there, Jamie.
I have to say, Dr. Cara, a year ago, you were blessed with the most beautiful baby, Adrian. She's turning a year this Saturday.
Yes.
And I can't believe that your body snapped back like that. It's unfair. It is so unfair. But how has motherhood been for you?
Wow, it's been a crazy, very fast ride. But really, she keeps us on our toes, definitely. But I can't say that it's just been the most rewarding experience. Just to see this little personality developing before your eyes, it's incredible.
My ovaries, stop what you're doing right now. And here's the thing, my little one is 2.5 years old, and I remember him being a newborn baby. It is so overwhelming because there's so many things that you want for them,
exactly.
So many essentials when it comes to buying for them. When it comes to buying for Adrian, what are some of your top tips? What details do you look for when you're looking for baby wear?
So obviously, adorable, that's number one. But then what's a priority to me is especially safety and comfort for baby. And this is why I love buying Woolies baby clothing, because they really make sure the baby's comfortable, because they make their baby clothes from special cotton and cotton blends. And then they also have the baby safety in mind. What I love about the safety component is if a needle breaks in the whole manufacturing process, the whole production line has to stop until every broken needle is recovered. And every garment undergoes a metal detector test as well. So that makes sure no harmful objects are left behind.
I said I was done after Luca. I was like, the boy, then you brought along this rail behind you. And I'm like, maybe I should go for the girl. But okay, I will just live through you today. What do you have for us on the rail?
So first of all, let's just start with the shoes. These are called the Woolies Walkmates.
Mudder.
And they are amazing. They're exclusive to Woolies Africa. And what I love about this, it has an anatomical fit, so it just accommodates for the baby's natural foot structure, which is great when they're learning how to walk. They've got breathable linings, leather uppers, and slip-resistant outer soles. And then if we just come over here to the baby grows, just safety components that they've included, all of their baby grows have this pull popper test, so just to make sure that none of them can come off and provide a choking hazard.
And convenient as well, because you know, in the middle of the night when you're trying to change the diaper, you just need something to open up as quick as possible.
And then these zip ones, they're the ultimate convenient ones. And they actually have like a little triangular zip guard to prevent any irritation in those delicate necks, in the skin. And then it's also always very important to make sure if there's any buttons, make sure it's double stitched so that it can't pop off as well. Then when it comes to these little joggers,
that might be my favorite right now.
My husband's favorite, like, you know, athlete. So they all, if you see any of these cord drawers, they all have little bar tack to prevent them from accidentally being pulled out and provide a strangulation risk, obviously. And if you see any of these embroideries or any decorative stitching, you can be assured that they all have this soft lining underneath to also prevent irritation of those baby skins. So
And I'm loving the pop of color as well, because you get to play around with it.
Exactly.
It gets to look cute. And we know that Adrian is a very fashion-forward baby. We'll check out on Instagram. Look at that face. Mommy, she was made for this life. But something that also caught my eye is the cutlery and just the crockery going on here. Take me through this.
So what's great about these cutlery and crockery sets is, well, the crockery is made of melamine, so it's perfect for on the go. If baby drops it, you know it's not going to just break that easily. It's also BPA free, dishwasher safe, and what I really find is so cute is these snack plates, because they obviously babies like to snack, everything gets everywhere, but these are actually designed by a local designer, Tori Stowe, and they're available pink and blue, and it's just stunning.
Also what I love is that you can actually compartmentalize it, because then you put like the fruit here, the vegetables, everything, the snacks, so then they can pick around.
Exactly.
My one is a bit fussy at the moment. He's like, the peas can't touch the carrots, can't touch anything. You're going to get there one day, but happy birthday in advance for Aiden for
Thank
Saturday.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much, Amy.
Now, Claude, of course, I'm glad that Woolies are taking action to ensure the safety of our little ones. Make Woolies a quality part of your baby's precious moments. And, of course, you can shop baby wear at Woolworths, and this is available in-store, online, or on the Woolworths app.
Yeah, we got something
Sub
special.
Sub
<Sub-yout. laughs>
And of course,
the kids are sorted, G, so we need to sort out something special. And we're talking about favorites here, right? We've got a South African classic. Now, imagine the milk tart, which, I mean, all South Africans love,
we
of course.
To.
And there's something else that you love to add to that as well. What's that? A cappuccino, I'm sure, right?
No, you've got to have it with something, okay?
So why don't we combine the two and make something special for Mzansi this morning?
Absolutely love it. So we're going to be using our vanilla eclair capsule this morning, which is lovely. It's beautiful. Biscuity, sweet notes, absolutely delicious. And we're using our Barista Creations device, which we love using because you can do so many things. We made a latte art using this device. It really is amazing. So what we're going to do here is we're going to create a coffee, and then we're going to finish it off with some beautiful flavor infusions that are going to take it all the way to milk tart. This is going to be something really special. So on the Barista device, I'm going to find the cappuccino dressing there. Then, okay, we're going to put in two tablespoons of, and it's, we're not going overboard here. It's just more for the kind of flavor profile, because this is a treat.
Yeah, and you don't also need to, I mean, the Barista blend on its own, I mean, the Eclair edition, which has got that beautiful flavor. For me, I think it comes with this really balanced note. It's got some mild acidity, some roastiness to it. But it doesn't have that sort of sweet after effect. So I think balancing it out with this is going to really get me excited, man. It's like a, earning it. And of course, just providing that extra little step that's needed to tick the box when it comes to the sweetness and give it that overall profile of flavor.
Let it do its thing there for a second. It actually works with a magnet underneath it. It's brilliant. It's absolutely amazing. So we're going to let that churn and do its thing. And I'm going to make us, I had a capsule in there. It's a waste.
It's always a pleasure watching you. This is like your science
room. Place, man.
You know,
I know, I'm a
when
mad
it comes
scientist.
To coffee, clearly this is your recipe. You've created something special here, Gene.
And I gotta love it, because I go through my capsules like, you know, like a wildfire. But yesterday Zoe brought me a whole bag because she had been keeping them, and she's like, yeah, I know you're gonna use these. I know you're gonna need them more
Zanzi,
than me.
By the way, if you want to find
Beautiful.
The way to cheese heart, then you get him some capsules. He will definitely love you over and over again for that.
Let's give it one more.
How are we doing over there?
Oh man, that smells absolutely amazing.
It does.
You know what's a beautiful crema.
What for me is, I wouldn't say the cherry on the top, but it really makes this, and especially during winter, it's something as simple as cinnamon.
Yeah.
It's literally like that umami loving food that you get, that warmth, that feel good factor. When you're adding it to a coffee or pairing it with a, I don't know, a creation like this, it just gives you that warmth and comfort that you're looking for in something in winter.
It's the ultimate comfort food. And I mean, you can play around with different flavor profiles. Maybe go with like a latte vibe with this. Go with some allspice. We're gonna go with another espresso blend, just smell that, dude. How lovely is that?
Ooh, that is good.
Don't drink it yet. Don't drink it yet.
Oh, expresso.show.com if you want to get this recipe inspiration. Right now, I'm spilling some Brazilian Arabicas. I've got some, I don't know, it's like a smokiness, a mildness to it. There's a roast.
Absolutely.
This alone
beautiful.
Is so good, man. Gee, why don't you just take it like this?
I know, I could. okay, let's finish this off. You could probably even let this go. Oh, that smells beautiful. So I'm going to finish yours off.
Thank you very much.
Barista
Ben. It's like silence as everybody waits.
Oh, it's magic, man.
Oh, look at that cinnamon popping through in the end there.
There we go. I'm not going to overfill it.
I've done yourself once again. Let me put the proof in the pudding, of course. Make sure you get yourself one there. Absolutely smells delicious.
I'm really excited for this one. Mm. It smells like a milk tart.
I'm literally smelling some vanilla, some custard notes on this, some warmth, some loving. This is how you start your morning. Let's put a sip in.
That was quite a build up, dude.
G-Man in the building, brother. I know what you want to do after that.
Oh,
cheers, man.
That tastes exactly like a malt tart. It's absolutely amazing. You can find this recipe on expressoshow.com. Get creative, have a little bit of fun. Find those, I think, old school nostalgic flavor profiles. And of course, it all starts with an amazing, beautiful coffee.
Cheers.
Lovely.
With every cup, we cultivate some of the finest coffee in the world, celebrating farmers as artists, elevating every coffee moment, because with every cup, precious coffee preserves the beauty of our world. Nespresso, what else?
It's my Feel Good Breakfast Show.
Welcome back. This is your Feel Good Breakfast Show, Expresso. We are very, very excited for our next guest because he is one of our favorites. And in fact, the last time he was on your Feel Good Breakfast Show was about 6 months ago. Can we please give Majozi a big Expresso welcome? I was just sharing a story about my dad is your biggest fan. He came to one of your album launches and he still to this day loves your music.
I'm upset because apparently he gave your parents VIP tickets and I didn't get
it. Put them on the list.
What's that?
Bro, it's
don't
coming, it's coming.
Lean was bio popular.
We're going to swap a hack for a show. Something like
okay,
that.
Deal. Listen, brother, it's so good having you in the studio again. Of course, it's been 6 months since we were graced with your beautiful presence. I've been following you so much since then, and everything that you do and you exude is just purely based on love. And it's so inspiring to me. It's my language that I speak. And some of your songs that you released, Falling and Close to You, which I believe also inspired by love and also inspired by your beautiful love that you have in your life, Daniela, of course.
Yeah.
But we don't stop there because you've added a third member to this beautiful ensemble of yours. I don't know what the name is exactly. Macielito, which is this random bear that keeps appearing. Man, what's happening with that? What's the inspiration behind it? Why are you using that to further express this language of love that you got going on?
Oh, well, thanks, man. Thanks for the kind intro. You guys are always too kind to me here.
We're just honest, man.
Well, yeah, I love my girlfriend a lot, you know, and it's been a wonderful relationship. And one of the gifts she gave me for our anniversary was a bear called Mizelito, which means a little piece of heaven. That was just something we used to call each other a lot because she is a half Argentinian, so she speaks Spanish. And I thought, you know, instead of people just seeing my face or her face or us together, I thought, like, it would be cool just to interject something different that's a little bit cute and a little bit universal. And, yeah, it's just fun, you know.
So the bear is, like, the third wheel. Can you play I feel like I'm the original third wheel to their relationship because when I went to the Ed Sheeran concert, I couldn't get to my friend, so I was hanging out with him and his girlfriend the whole Ed Sheeran.
They just left it. I was like,
no, they were like right in the front, and you know how tight that circle can be. You can't get to the front. But Majozi, I was, you know what? I'm loving your Majozi range that you brought out, and I know you're rocking one right now. Yes,
boom,
yes.
Boom.
Can people get a hold of it, or is it very exclusive?
No, listen, we are selling it. We are definitely selling it. So, like, this has been a labor of love. I've really loved doing this because my mom used to make jerseys when I was younger, and unfortunately, she's passed away now. So, like, there's a lot of sentimental ties to it for me. And I found this guy, Ryan, from Africa Made Only, and I was like, I really want to do this, and I knew he could help me because he sources materials locally, he works with local people, works with giving people jobs, seamstresses, and the guys that make the jerseys, so I've really loved doing this. So this is my second run, the loved edition. The last one had my face and my girlfriend's face on it, so we were like, maybe people don't want to wear our faces, so we'll do something a little bit simpler, you know, for the winter, better quality. Yeah, it's just something that I've really enjoyed doing, and you can just go check it out on my website or Africa Made Only. And it's getting cold now, so why not get one?
Get yourself in the jersey.
Of course, get comforted with love in that beautiful jersey. Now let's talk about some performances. Obviously, we're going to be blessed to see you tantalize us today on the show, but for the rest of Mzansi, I believe you've got a performance happening at the Daisy Jones Bar in Stellenbosch, which is coming up, right?
Yes,
what can
up,
we
man.
Expect? What's happening? What's the lowdown? Tease us, man.
Yeah, man. So, well, it's you know, it's been so tricky trying to do shows with lockdown, especially now we're in level three, you know, and trying to be responsible and think about people. But luckily, Daisy Jones is a huge venue. It's quite big, and it's limited to 50 people, you know. Okay. So everyone's going to be well spread out, and I love playing shows in Stellenbosch. It's always a big jewel, and it's a new venue. I haven't played there before, so I'm really, really excited. So playing on the 2nd of July. So if you guys want to come, let me know if you guys want to come at home as well.
Will I finally maybe get a VIP shot?
Oh,
bro.
No, add you to the guest list.
Yes.
And speaking of July, I know your birthday is coming up.
Yes.
Any special plans? Are you going to release any other Majozis or the music?
I don't know, man. Like, I'm so, like, The older I get, the less I care about my birthday, to be honest. Maybe I'll go watch. I haven't watched a movie in a long time. I think maybe I'll spoil myself with a movie or something like that. But, like, you know, I am turning 34. So if people want to send me stuff, please feel free to send me stuff. I'll take anything.
Aww.
Well, Majozi, so much of a pleasure to have you in the studio this morning. And, of course, this doesn't end here. We are getting some beautiful performances with him later on, so stick around for that. But, again, that performance that is happening pretty soon is the 2nd of July. You want to check that one out. You can get your tickets at quicket.co.za. It's happening in Stellies. But before we get into the Stellies action, don't worry, because you will be tantalizing us soon, so stick around. See you soon.
Just 1 minute before 7 o'clock, time to have a second look at those news headlines. Starting with your national news, President Cyril Ramaphosa yesterday announced that the National Ports Authority is to become an independent subsidiary of Transnet with its own board. He said the creation of the entity will allow the Port Authority to make its own investment decisions and ensure that it treats all terminal operators fairly and equally. He said this was part of the government's efforts to accelerate economic structural reforms. Now, Public Enterprises Minister Praveen Gordhan will appoint the interim board of the new entity by the end of this month. And then President Cyril Ramaphosa yesterday said the government is considering imposing tighter lockdown restrictions, particularly in Gauteng, where the number of COVID-19 infections continues to rise dramatically. Meanwhile, private hospitals have suspended visits and some elective surgeries. And some 120,000 South Africans currently have COVID-19, according to the latest data from the National Institution for Communicable Diseases. And more than 9,300 people have been admitted to hospitals, 6,200 are in private hospitals, and 3,100 in public hospitals. And then looking to news further abroad, the Vatican confirmed yesterday it had lodged a diplomatic protest against a draft Italian law condemning homophobia. The so-called ZAN law seeks to punish acts of discrimination and incitement to violence against gay, lesbian, transgender, and physically challenged people. Since 2013, Pope Francis has adopted a softer tone on homosexuality and has agreed to same-sex couples being granted legal recognition. Nevertheless, the Vatican continues to defend marriage as being between a man and a woman, opposes gay adoptions, and sees gender ideology as a threat to traditional family values. And then Gabon has become the first African country to receive payment for reducing carbon emissions by protecting its rainforest. The UN-backed Central African Forest Initiative has handed over 232 million rand, the first tranche of a multi-billion rand deal struck in 2019. Now, nearly 90% of Gabon is covered by forest, which captures more carbon than the country emits. Rainforests are vital for absorbing the globe's climate heating emissions. Gabon has managed to reduce deforestation and so lower its carbon emissions year on year, and as a result receive the money. And now for some interesting news from the world of entertainment. Actor George Clooney and other Hollywood A-listers, including Kerry Washington and Don Cheadle, are to open a school to train teens in cinematography, lighting, visual effects, and other Hollywood jobs. The school, due to launch in 2022, is aimed at diversifying the entertainment industry by providing a path to well-paid jobs that have few formal entryways. Now, said Clooney, and I quote, "Our aim is to better reflect the diversity of our country. It means creating high school programs that teach young people about cameras, editing and visual effects and sound, and all the career opportunities that this industry has to offer," end quote. Now, the school will be housed in the predominantly Latino Westlake district of Los Angeles, and Clooney, Washington, Cheadle and Eva Longoria will sit on the board and cover about 20% of the initial expected budget of some $7 million. Hollywood has sought to increase the number of people of color in front and behind the camera since the hashtag #OscarsSoWhite scandal in 2016. Now, those efforts received a further boost last year when the Black Lives Matter protest fueled a wider debate on racism at American institutions. Well, that is where I leave your 7 a.m. headlines. Here is G with a look at the sports.
Well, with the rain plummeting outside, you can probably hear it. We'll get into our weather in just a moment. But first, let's get into our sporting results, starting with cricket yesterday. India now lead New Zealand by 32 runs with 8 wickets remaining as they go into the reserve 6th day of the World Test Championship final at the Aegeus Bowl in Southampton today. Tim Southee picking up the wickets of both Indian openers as they finished on 64 for 2 in their second innings at stumps. So earlier, New Zealand turned their overnight result of 101 for 2 to 249. All out. That World Test Championship final will continue from 11:30 a.m. SA time today. Then finally on top football, the 12th minute header from close range by Man City forward Raheem Sterling, securing a 1-0 win for England against the Czech Republic and in turn confirming their place in the Euro 2020 last 16. So England finish at the top of Group D with 7 points. Other results from last night, Croatia looked impressive, recording a 3-1 victory over Scotland in Glasgow. That was thanks to goals from midfielders Nikola Vlasic, Luka Modric and Ivan Perisic. There'll be 4 Euro 2020 fixtures today. And that includes defending European champions Portugal up against world champions France in a must-see encounter at 9 p.m. And then staying with the point, Wembley Stadium in London will now accommodate more than 60,000 spectators for the semi-finals and finals of the Euro 2020s. So the UK government confirmed this yesterday. The increase will see the largest crowds gather for a sports event in the United Kingdom in more than 15 months. The Euro 2020 semi-finals will take place on the 6th and 7th of July and the final being played on the 11th of next month. Well, that's where we leave our sport for this hour. With the rain falling so heavily outside, let's get a weather update and see how the weather is looking across the globe right now with Jamie.
Let's first have a look at those weather news. Now, with the deadly tropical depression Claudette downgraded yesterday to a remnant low and it dissipated over the Atlantic southeast of the U.S. coastline, there has been great interest in the naming of the hurricanes, which are chosen by the World Meteorological Organization each year. Now, Native Americans called these destructive storms hurricanes after, I quote, a great spirit who commanded the east wind. Now, Spanish explorers adopted the word and then began giving hurricanes the names of patron saints, and in 1950 a formal practice for storm naming was developed by the U.S. National Hurricane Center. At that time, storms were named according to a phonetic alphabet, but in 1953 the system was revised so that storms would be given female names. Now, this mimicked the habits of old naval meteorologists who named the storms after their wife or girlfriend, much the way ships at sea were named after women. And in 1979 the system was revised again to include both female and male names. And then, of course, while we enjoy experiencing a sunrise from your part of South Africa, we do have some international viewers tuning in on both YouTube and the Africa channel in the USA. And this morning, we report on the city of Atlanta, ATL, the capital city of Georgia, as well as the most populous city of the state. Now, the city is situated among the foothills of the Appalachian Mountains and has the highest elevation among major cities east of the Mississippi River. The Atlanta History Center chronicles the city's past, and the Martin Luther King Jr. National Historic Site is dedicated to the African American leader's life and times. Now, downtown Centennial Olympic Park, built for the 1996 Olympics, encompasses the massive Georgia Aquarium. Today, if you are in the ATL Atlanta area, you can expect a mostly sunny and pleasant day ahead, reaching a maximum of 29 degrees Celsius. And then bringing it back to our own shores, we received some more stunning sunrise images from our viewers based in South Africa. Monique van Rensburg from Gqeberha, who shared this beautiful skyline showing off views of blue, pink and yellow. And then another one coming through from a regular contributor Intokozo Theo Makatini from Joburg shared yet another great photo with us showing off the clouds illuminated by the moon still in the sky as it transitions from night to day. And if you would like to share your sunrise photo with us, head on over to the Expresso Facebook page. It is really that simple. But right now it's time to have a second look at the temperatures for today. If you do find yourself in Polokwane today, do expect a low of 6, peaking at 21. For you, Umbombela, it ranges from 11 to 29. And then for Pretoria, a low of 7 to a high of 19 is expected. Johannesburg, for you, it is 6.17. Mahikeng ranges from 4 to 21. And then for Klerksdorp, it is a minimum of 3, peaking at 20 today. Kimberley, 6.22. Bloemfontein ranges from 1 to 20. And then if you're out and about in Richards Bay, expect a low of 11 and a high of 25. Pietermaritzburg following shortly with a low of 7 and a high of 25. And then South Africa's playground, Durban, ranges from 17 to 26. Mthatha, for you, it is 11.25. East London, partly cloudy conditions, but rain is expected with a low of 14, peaking at 22. Craddock, 7.23. Gqeberha, for you, it is 10.19. George, for you, rain is expected with a low of 10 and a high of 18. And then the mother city, Cape Town, can expect 59% chance of rain with a low of 10 and a high of 15. Worcester, 7.15. Sutherland, 1.12. And then Upington with a range of 6 to 24. Wherever you find yourself, make sure it is a feel-good kind of day.
Thank you, Jamie. Well, listen, it's time for us to go head-to-head in some fun. Now, Graham, I know you are the sports guy on this show. You are.
I love it. I'm so passionate about sports. Obviously, rugby being a massive thing, but I think it's the unifying force with all of us in this country, whether it's your tennis, whether it's your cricket, whether it's your life-saving, whether it's your rugby. The passion is in the game, and we get so emotionally invested. And for me, also a little bit of football when it comes to Spurs, maybe in the wrong way. Lindsay can never understand why I'm, like, upset for an entire weekend if the Springboks lose. I get really upset. It's not a thing.
I can relate to you so much, Gian. Even though you are a rugby fanatic and I'm maybe more life-saving water-orientated, I'm a water baby, I still see so many similarities when you look at the sport. I mean, there's this commitment, there's this hard work, there's this teamwork, there's so many variables
teamwork
when it comes to it. Yeah, man, so I definitely can relate to you there.
And you guys have a serious bromance going on, so I kind of thought we need to play around a bit, get some competition between the two of you, and put your general knowledge, in fact, your sports knowledge to the test. So I will be the games master.
Nothing's going to tear us apart, sorry.
No, I'm not trying to tear you apart. I'm just trying to figure out who knows more than the other one. Okay. So I need a special sound from each of you.
A special sound. David Hasselhoff.
Are you going to really shout that every time
you're
going to Okay.
Steven Seagal.
Okay. Well, there we go. This is how the game's going to work. As you heard, they have their unique sounds. And I'm going to ask them a sport or a different... I'm going to ask them a question around life-saving or rugby. The first one to give me their signal as soon as I finished the question, they have the right to answer. And if they get it wrong, we'll give the other contestant a chance to also see if they can get it correct. Okay. Are you ready?
Okay, cool.
All right.
Okay, here is your first question. In rugby, the referee stops play because a player was in touch. What did the referee spot?
Steven Seagal.
What?
That a player's foot was either on the line or across the sideline of the field and therefore out.
Let's check, is that correct? Yeah. Yes, it is. It's 1 point for him.
I knew that one, by the way. I always think it's weird. When you... in touch, you are out the field. It's like the most confusing thing
in
rugby.
He's in touch. He's out.
Okay, next question. In life-saving, what is the hand signal for assistance required?
David Hasselhoff.
What is it?
Wave above the head, one arm in a calm manner means assistance required. And if it's two arms, this is a distress signal. This is what you don't want to see.
Like, hurry up.
Like, hurry up, distress. This is
okay. Correct.
Like
well done.
In a calm
one
manner.
Point each.
How do you do that in a calm manner?
Hey, okay. Can you Next question. On April 16th, 2004, the DHL Stormers beat the Blues in New Zealand in a Super 12 encounter. Ooh. What year, previous to this, did this last happen?
I'm not even going to try this one, Jeeves.
Take a guess.
What?
Steven Seagal. So now I... The one thing, okay, so I'm a big Carlos Spencer fan, and the Blues had their magical year in 2003, and he was like the top scorer, and it was an amazing time for them.
That's before
and
I know, he became a coach player
That's the thing, and I actually got to play a game of rugby with them and just saw how amazing it was. So, like, I know it wasn't 2003 or 2002, the Blues were really strong about that. I actually have no idea. I'm going to say 2001.
Okay.
Or 2000.
The year 2000, is that your final answer?
Yeah.
What?
That was it. That was right. Apparently, it was right.
Was it incorrect?
Was it? Oh, that was an amazing guess to you.
I said, no, it is correct. Well done.
I corrected myself.
So, okay, the fact that it was Super 12 should have been a dead giveaway. It was long ago.
Yeah, it was very long ago.
Because we've gone from Super 12 to Super 14. Super Rugby.
Yeah, no, that was, I can't believe I had to, like,
well played, Ben.
Well done. Okay, well done. The answer is the year 2000. Okay, James, this is the last question. This is the tiebreaker. In fact, I think it is. Okay. Whoever gets this right wins. Now, CPR and AED training is a required component of the lifeguard certification program. In a case of cardiac arrest due to a drowning incident or a heart attack on land, the lifeguard needs to be trained on CPR and the use of an AED in order to keep the victim's heart, in fact, heart beating until emergency medical services arrives. What does AED stand for?
So AED is an artificial external defibrillator. It's an awesome tool. It's probably one of the most valuable things that you'll get in life saving and to save someone's life.
Is that
where they say clear?
It's not even that. It's so cool that it's advanced beyond you even needing to say anything. All you do is you put the machine on the person's body. The machine does a full diagnostic.
Figures it out.
Tells you whether you need to administer breaths or not, and then gives the shock if
you need it. Can you repeat that answer again?
It's insane. An artificial external defibrillator. How cool is that?
There we go. Okay. Point to you. I feel like that's now a tie.
Yeah.
Okay. Bonus question, because this is the tiebreaker. How many years has DHL been in partnership with the DHL Stormers?
Yeah. It's been a while.
Yeah. No, but I need years. It's been a partnership.
8 years or more, surely.
As long as I can remember.
Give me a number. Let's see who's closest.
Steven Seagal is going to go with 10 years.
10.
I honestly think it's close. I was at 8 or 9. I'm going to go 9 years.
9? Okay. What is the answer? Let's see on the big screen. It is 10 years indeed.
Oh, Gina. Wow.
It's been a decade.
Check at this, man.
See, you don't mess with Steven Seagal, man. That was challenging.
Well done. Your rugby knowledge, your life-saving knowledge is incredible. The bromance is still strong. But the two of you, well done.
Oh, I love it.
Okay. Well, listen, if you want to delve deeper into the parallels between the DHL Stormers and lifeguards, then tune in on Friday morning where Graham and Ryle, they head on over to Clifton Forth Beach to catch up with the teams from both sports to prove that they are not that different at all.
I think I pulled my brain.
Can't wait to see it.
It's my feel-good breakfast show. Welcome back. You are still live with Expresso. Thank you so much for staying tuned. Time to get creative. Everything we interact with on a daily basis has been designed by someone, and Decorex Cape Town is celebrating designers and their unique designs with their 2021 Design Trail, taking visitors on a design journey, if you will, throughout the mother city. And one of the very exciting design destinations is creative agency Clout SA. What a name. Here to tell us more about the space and what we can can expect is Clout SA creative director Tracy Lee Lynch. Welcome to the show.
Thanks so much for having me.
Oh, I'm loving your outfit, but I have to also tell you that every time I drive through town, I see the yellow stickers and I'm like, ooh, yeah, that is a DecorX exhibition. That's part of the design trail.
So clever.
Now, I wanted to, yeah, it is very clever. I wanted to know from you, Tracy Lee, when it comes to Clout SA, what is the concept behind it?
So we are a purpose-first business, and our focus is the promotion of the creative communities of South Africa, specifically art and design.
Okay.
So the project was seeded in the Nando's world, and now we're reaching out to find new partners to broaden the opportunity. We create mentorship programs for emerging designers, competitions to draw out new talent.
Sure.
We showcase locally and we showcase globally, and we also put together curated collections. And we facilitate logistics. So there's quite a lot that goes into it. It's a really wonderful space to draw out entrepreneurs and help young people find ways to build businesses.
Mm. I love it because it's kind of, it's hitting the challenge on a number of levels as well. Why go that route? Why not sell out, become a big commercial concern, go after the big bucks? Why focus on building the kind of ladder from the bottom rung all the way up?
I think just because we are so invested in the creative economies. So we really believe that there's so much more to this. And also to bring positive messaging from South Africa. We really all want to feel incredibly energized and optimistic about this incredible place where we live,
yeah,
and the energy that's here and the craft and the creativity. And sharing that with the world has been such a joy, and sharing that locally as well and making people feel like they're part of something really special.
Yeah.
So that really is a big part of the drive.
And advertising can do that. Mm. You know, that creative space can do that.
Yes.
And I love everything you were saying that Clout SA stands for and what it represents. So from the DecorX design trail aspect, what can people take away from a design perspective when they come to Clout SA?
Well, we've got a temporary exhibition at Union House, and it's over four floors. We're launching 20 new products by established and emerging designers. There are more than 30 designers represented, more than 10 artists represented. It's an absolute visual explosion of creativity and craft and artisanal mosaicing and beadwork. It really is world class and incredibly exciting to see. So it's just a very tactile experience of the best of what we have to offer. Very special.
You say tactile. Are there interactive elements? How can people experience
that space? Yes, because all of the designers are there on the ground.
Oh,
so they're
brilliant.
There. We've been very careful how we've structured the spaces. Mm-hmm. No more than 10 guests come through at a time, and they are able to talk to the established designers and the emerging designers that are there to share what they focus is and their design approach and their creativity.
I love that, and it's so nice to be able to connect with the designer and get their perspective or where they were from or the vision behind it, which really just connects so well.
Yeah, completely. And I love the fact that you're kind of using your space in DecorX to promote other people, which I think probably holds true to your vision of what you're trying to achieve. How important is it for these designers to enter into the space? What do they get out of this experience?
Well, they've been exposed to incredible industry specialists, from property developers, architects, interior designers, to the media, and then also we're having a day tomorrow when students come through so they can inspire the next generation of designers. So I think it's been an opportunity to meet and greet and then share their vision and story,
yeah,
in the hopes that like-minded businesses will jump at the opportunity to partner and create creative opportunities for these entrepreneurs. It's really important that local businesses look to the creative communities and find ways, and we're there to facilitate that.
And you're making it easier.
Economy. Yeah, there absolutely love it. Tracy, thank you so much for the work that you do, and good luck with this very exciting new spin on DecorX. I think it really is such a clever way of everything considered, kind of meeting the challenge head on. So thank you so much for joining
us
this morning.
Thank you.
There we go. Well, do check out Clout SA, and of course, you can see all the best of designs and designers behind it. And on this year's DecorX Cape Town Design Trail, you can visit decorx.co.za. to register and get more information about this very exciting exhibits that's available, and look out for the yellow stickers because they're everywhere.
Are you ready? Mzanzi, are you ready? Because we've got an incredible friend of Expresso in studio with us throughout the morning. He's here. He's going to be delivering his latest hits a little later on. But first, singer and songwriter Majozi is taking us all the way back to 2011 to perform his rendition of the hit David Guetta track featuring Sia called Titanium. You ready? Mzanzi, you ready? Take it away.
Thank you.
Oh my gosh, setting the tone here on your Feel Good Breakfast Show on this Wednesday. Of course, be sure to catch Majozi performing live at the Daisy Jones Bar in Stellenbosch on Friday, the 2nd of July. Now, doors open at 5 p.m. and the show starts at 7 p.m. and you can get your tickets from cricket.co.za. But we've got two more awesome performances coming your way from Majozi, so stick around for it.
Becoming a parent fills you with delight, nerves, and questions. Now, an original South African app has the answers. Whether you're expecting your bundle of joy or raising a preschooler, the Purity Journey Journal app is a breeze to use. Sign up for free and choose from a host of features, including 24/7 medical assistance, expert tips, and milestone tracker. Sign up to the Purity Journey Journal app for whenever you need some guidance along your parenting journey.
It's my feel-good breakfast show.
Man, I wish I had hair for this, but I can't and I don't have hair. But you know that sound means that JP Sebastian is here with all the latest movie trailers. Maybe you can
one
share with
fan. Real.
Yeah, two beds. Okay, the rest of it.
Graham got really loud that moment. No, if I do hair things, then our makeup artist, Bernice Freylink, will be very angry with me. If this flops around, it gets
gone.
Very misbehaved.
Nothing. That's why I keep it short, eh?
You know
that's
our people with the movable hair? That's a lie. Let's move on. Movies.
Okay, first movie is Nowhere Special.
Yes.
By the way, before we get into it, is it any horrors? Because you've been hitting us with a lot of horrors lately.
That's life hitting us with horrors. but these are just true stories,
okay.
Dramas.
Okay.
At least this one's inspired by a true story.
Oh.
So, yeah, the kind of thing that's going to be tears galore for people, I'm sure. Heartstrings. Just like straight up emotionally manipulative is what these trailers are, no doubt. And I'm pretty sure I'll cry when the movies come out. But there are no dates for this one in SA just yet. Nowhere Special, my favorite date night, is the story of a guy who's 35 years old. And yes, just horrid, sad life. And he's got a four-year-old kid, simple blue-collar guy. He's a window cleaner, and he's loyal to the kid, and he grinds at that, and he tries to keep everything on an even keel. They have their daily routine together, the two of them, but finds out from a doctor that he has only months to live.
Oh, no.
Yeah, it's a bad start.
Yeah, no, I'm crying already. I'm already... emotional.
And throughout the trailer, this kid's like, he's at home with his dad no matter where they are, at the top of a bridge, this, you know, symbolic transitionary sort of like infrastructural device. What a weird way to describe a bridge. The kid says, I am home, like, without a sense of really acting. The little three-year-old, four-year-old kid, whatever he is, just seems to hold his own in this movie quite fine. This dude, by the way, I think is from a TV show called Broadchurch. You might recognize his face from there, nevertheless. And so, yeah, throughout the entire thing, the trailer lets on that he's trying desperately to find a new family for his little boy. The mother left after she gave birth and left the two of them alone together. Again, inspired by a true story. No, why do this to us? Seriously, it's going to be heartbreaking stuff. And so he's like... you know, we try to act so profound and philosophical about, oh no, but you have to teach your kids about these things. But the dude is a parent and he's like, I don't want my kid to know about death. Like, not at this age. Like, no one should have to. And so he has his own internal fight about, how do I move forward? How do I describe this to the little guy? And all the while, this kid's got this sort of quiet wisdom to him. Because kids know when something's up. So no date in essay just yet, but, you know, prepare the...
I can't wait for the
brand name tissues that are concerned
because I really want to watch this. I cry for reality TV shows. You can imagine what this is going to do for me. I'm going to be sitting there with like a box of tissues.
Yes, if ever I have to see Khloe Kardashian again, I cry too. Joe Bell, starring Mark Wahlberg, who is in something quite different from the usual year. So when I read a little synopsis about this, you know, father goes on a rampage against bullying in America, I was like, oh, of course he's going to be like, I don't know, stabbing people with the American flag and, I don't know, firing eagles out of a shotgun or something like that, because he does this macho cliche stuff. But yeah, it's quite a different bent from everything that he's used to. Father of a young son who's got his own flam.
A real son.
And based on a true story, by the way. The little boy that you're watching there played really remarkably just from this trailer by this new coming actor, Reed Miller, I think his name is. Has a bright future ahead of him, clearly is, was in real life a kid named Jaden Bell who committed suicide when he was being bullied at school for being gay. And in real life, the father, Joe Bell, played here by Mark Wahlberg after this tragic, horrible event. And the society that we've made decides to walk across society, walk across the United States, go to high schools across America and just say, why are we tearing each other apart like this? Talking to kids in the LGBT community, trying to help them through the pain that they're going through. But man, this kid looks like an amazing actor. And like I said, it's not often that we get to see Mark Wahlberg doing a more tender side kind of thing. It looks like one of these Oscar grab type things or whatever, but really heartstrings, emotionally manipulative. Like I said, I look forward to it. No date in essay just yet, but obviously it's going to knock it out the park, I'm pretty sure, for a lot of people. Joe Bell.
When this does come out, please just bring me again another box of tissues because we are going to need it. You have another one called The Eyes of Tammy Faye.
That's a very strange name, isn't it? Mm. So this is another true story, and this is about a famous couple. People might know because this guy's still got a TV show. You can see it on South African TV on that religious broadcasting network. Jim Baker and Tammy Faye were two evangelical, televangelical Christian, you know, preachers on TV. She starts off, Jessica Chastain, by the way, undergoing a huge transformation. Oscars love this kind of thing when an actor gains weight or they had to put in like a mouthpiece for the entire shooting of the thing. So maybe this is in line for that kind of consideration too. And she's just a fantastic actress. I love her dearly. Anything she does, she's so dynamic. She plays a totally, speaking on flamboyant, like over the top type character, as you can already see by her makeup in some of these shots. In real life, Tammy Faye was, back in the 60s, an interesting kind of Christian to this community that was, a lot of it was money grabbing and a lot of it was cynical. She actually seemed to have like a heart in a place for wanting to do the right thing. She brought on LGBT kids and people with HIV and AIDS onto this TV show at a time that it was, you know, ostracized and quite persecuted by that kind of community. Jim Baker, by the way, in real life, went to jail for 5 years, sentenced for 45, for owing the US government in today Rand's values $2 billion. In tax evasion, and guess who has a TV show to this day? And last year tried to sell people fake COVID vaccines. Anyway, so this one, like, I'm pretty sure will be in line for Oscar consideration kind of thing. Jessica Chastain has been there before, and no doubt she pulls out the stops for this one too. Doing this type of rope kind of character who's like, wants to be honest, but likes the money. If you like Wolf of Wall Street, this one's for you.
There is a release date for this.
Oh, yeah, that's October 1st, if I got that correct. But yeah, anytime this year, who knows how, you know, pandemic permitting, how the calendar goes.
Indeed. Well, listen, JP Sebastian is not going anywhere. He still has more movie trailers coming your way, so stick around for that.
Nice. Thank you so much, JP, and of course, Jamie. Now, keeping in line with movies, we've got something special for you, and we're talking about a 16-time world champion wrestler turned movie star. His name is John Cena. He's joined by Vin Diesel and the rest of the cast for the latest installment of that Fast and the Furious franchise, Fast 9. Now, the former wrestler takes on the role of the ripped Jacob Toretto in this film, right? And in order to look this part, we've got to do something special, of course.
We are definitely doing something special. I mean, John Cena had to train
5 days a week, focusing on different body elements. He was focusing on legs and calves, arms and shoulders. He didn't skip a body part to prepare himself for this role. And Raul is about to take me through the type of workout that John Cena would have focused on, but of course, keeping it lady friendly. I don't want to have big arms like him. I want to be toned.
We're going to keep it Mzansi friendly. We're going to do exactly that, Zoe. So obviously with John Cena, I mean, if you've seen the guy, he is so stacked. He was wrestling. He did the FU finisher. He'd pick up people like the great Khalil, who weighed over like 150 kgs. So we're not going to get that intense. Yep. It's not needed, but we still want to recreate the look. We still want to get the stimulation. So today we've got two parts coming at you. We're going to get the whole body. We're not going to miss a dime. We're starting off with this session and working on the lower body to try to create what John Cena did. And we're not going to miss out on any of the smaller muscles either. So we're going to start off with something called calves.
Yes.
We all have them.
We always forget about them.
We always forget about them when you're skipping leg day. This is a big culprit of the leg day skipping. But today we're going to sort that out and get some good calves in the building. So I've set up a system and somewhat of a gym equipment exercise that can be done literally in your own home. Any chair that you have and any form of a platform that can be raised. You could stack up a pair of books. So if you have three books right over here, it'll do the exact same thing. You can use a brick outside of the house or a rock, it doesn't matter. But what you do need is the chair. So while Zoe and I are sitting on the chair, what we're gonna do is the following. Level one for a calf raise, we're gonna put both of our feet on the platform and simply applying a little bit of pressure with our arms right down onto the fib tip of our lower leg. We're gonna press down and try and resist that pressure and let our calves eccentrically load all the way down. So we're getting a good stretch here. Now, while pressing as hard as you can, you wanna lift your calves up, 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 up. Resist that pressure, get a good squeeze, pointing your toes, and then doing the exact same thing. And you're gonna repeat this for 12 reps and at least 4 sets in total. Now, Zoe.
My glutes are like, is that normal?
That is normal because the entire body's gonna kind of brace for this. You're pretty strong though, Zoe, and I think we need a little bit of a challenge. So let's step this up a bit. Let's cross our leg over and put it on top of our knee. What this means is we're gonna add extra weight onto the leg, which is on the platform, and we can press this top leg. And at the same time, we're getting a little bit of a glute stretch. Yeah, efficiency.
Okay.
Let's talk about it. So again, 12 reps in total. Now what you want to do is, again, press the entire region down. You might get a little bit of a shaking on the way up as well, like you'll see with my leg over here. That's me pushing against the resistance. I'm really applying force here. And as you squeeze it at the top, hold for 2 seconds, isometric hold, and then slowly all the way back down. Now, if you want size like John Cena, you want to focus on this eccentric load. Really, really make it slow, make it controlled. If you want power and speed, then it's a poof. As fast up as you can. So let me show you that again, Mzansi. Coming close to my feet over here. If I want size on my calf, it's the eccentric load. So while I'm pushing down, I really want to control this motion, really, really applying my force. If I want power and speed, it's a simple poof, explode up. You like that?
Yeah.
Nice and simple. Okay. So if that was too easy for you as well, don't worry, Zoe and I got you covered. We're gonna do something called a standing calf raise now. So again, this doesn't have the stretching stimulation that we got from the glutes, but we are gonna get extra stimulation from stabilizing ourselves. So what we're gonna do is try to step up onto the platform now with one foot, all right?
Mm-hmm.
The other foot is literally gonna be behind you. Now really, this is a challenge. And what we're gonna do is try and release our calf all the way down and then all the way straight back up. And then all the way down. Whoop, it's a little bit harder than I thought.
And then
all the way back up again.
Okay, let's see if I can do it.
See
if I can do it. Okay, so we're gonna start. Ooh.
Yeah, there's those stabilizers. All the way up if you can. Beautiful, nice, and then all the way down. Now you really wanna try and control this movement. It's a lot harder than it looks. If you can get up and down already, that is brilliant because you're stabilizing your core already working on that. If you can then incorporate some slow speed to this, oh, you're gonna get some brilliant stimulation. Are you feeling that burn, right?
I am feeling it, but it's also I'm rushing because I'm like trying not to lose my balance.
Exactly, so don't try to rush this one, especially when it comes to calves. You wanna get that stimulation, you wanna grow it, you wanna get it to that point where we can be John Cena ready. All right, last one for leg day, of course. We've done the lower half of the legs, which is the calves. Let's move to the upper half. Another reason why we do this, John Cena literally, Zoe, takes someone above his head and does this. Wah! Throws him away. That is the FU. So we have to train our legs. Squats are important. And the reason why we've got the chair here again, it's a great guide to see how low you need to go with your legs. So getting your glutes to go onto the chair, trying to not let your knees go too far forward, away from your feet, but a nice eccentric load all the way down until you tap the chair, and then slowly bringing it straight back up, all right? You want to squeeze your glutes at the same time when you're doing that. So perfect form. I love that neutral spine as well. You've got a nice shoulder width stance in your legs, and that will complete your full body lower workout. Of course, it's John Cena getting us ready for that Fast 9 tutorial. We're coming at you with a round two, of course, where we're going to hit the upper body and see how we can get some Cena guns. So stick around for that one, of course. Finish off this lower body exercise and meet us later, because we're going to get straight back into it. Cena time! Yeah!
Nourish your skin with Ingram's Moisture Plus, enriched with triple glycerine. For 48-hour intensive moisture. Ingram's, your skin, your brave.
It's my feel-good breakfast show.
Welcome back, beautiful souls. Oh, we are sweating it out. We're getting that workout going. And I'm joined by the beautiful Zoe, of course. We've just finished a lower body workout. It's in aid of getting John Cena ready and in aid of that beautiful movie coming out. It's Fast 9 in the building. All the Full Throttle fans are going to love it. And, of course, back with an exciting fitness segment on how to get a body like former WWE star. But before we get into it, we've got some Good Morning posts which we pose to you guys in terms of, aside from Vin Diesel and John Cena, who would you trust to drive you out of danger?
Ooh.
Let's see what the peeps had to say, Zoe.
So I'll have a look here. Vivia says, Tom Cruise. Yeah, the dude can drive almost anything and still walk in the end.
There we go. You can fly as well.
There we go. Colleen says, Ryle DeMornay. With arms like that, he'll steer us out of danger. Whoop, whoop. There we go. And then we also have one that came through from Pathfinder, The Rock, Dwayne Johnson.
Yeah, you can't go wrong with The Rock. The Brahma Bull himself, another former WWE star. So let's get into it. I mean, these guys are packed. The upper bodies, oh man, it's like on another level. I remember when I was a kid? When I was a kid, this was pure, pure gold. So we're going to start off with something simple, maybe? Not sure. And then we'll move over to even using some weights. And again, Mzanzi, don't stress. You don't have weights. You can use some of these bottles like we use in the Clover Crush. You can use a water bottle. Anything that you have at home that has some weight will do. All right, so this one is actually a Tropica Crush that we're going to be using. Tropica Island of Treasure inspired. But before we get into it, we're going to start off with something simple. So the first one is a diamond push-up, right? So Zoe, let me show you how the actual movement works before we get into it. The reason why we're calling it a diamond is because you're creating a diamond with our hand. That shape onto the ground is where our hands would be. So remember in a push-up,
hands are nice and close.
Normally shoulder width apart. Making it closer means we're going to use more of the shoehorn tricep, and it increases the stimulation on the pec and the shoulder as well. So in that bridged position, diamonding it out, you want to go all the way down. Now you can see I'm using those triceps. Check how my arms are shaking. Get all the way down to the ground. Big stimulation, and then pressing straight back up. Again, keeping a neutral spine. Now, obviously, this is quite a tricky movement, right? If you are just starting out, Zoe and I are going to show you an easier grade that you can do at home. You just need a chair again or a platform, exactly the same position. So having your hands in a diamond, just like Zoe has, a beautiful neutral spine, and watch as she easily and elegantly lowers herself as low as she can. She doesn't have to go all the way down if she can't. That right there was a perfect grip. So your goal then is to try to get your hand as close to your chest as possible. Every time you do the exercise, you'll advance and get lower. What you're doing right now, though, is perfect. Still getting stimulation on this tricep, still getting the pecs engaged, and again, of course, still getting John Cena ready.
We'll need to figure out a female version of that name.
Yeah. So the diamond obviously is quite a hard one. What we do there is get strength. What we're going to now try to do is also get some size in the pec, right? So we're going to go for a wide push-up, and this is something you can try on the ground now.
Okay.
So we can do away with the chair. If you do want to grade this, always as simple as just resting your knees on the ground instead of your feet. But the width is coming from our hand position once again. So if I was shoulder width apart in this position, you literally want to go about, I'd say, 2 feet or a foot width away from that shoulder. So there's a lot more stimulation on the pec than there is on the tricep for this one. So really going to get a good stretch and an eccentric load at the same time. And again, we're all just simply lowering our body all the way down to the ground, nice and slow, eccentric load. See if you can hang out there for a bit and then bring your body straight
back up. You're making it look easy.
Ah, Naza, I've seen you do this. You got this. All the way down. Oh, there we go. Beautiful stuff. And all the way up. I love how you're keeping your spine and your core engaged and neutral. That is absolutely perfect stuff. Beautiful form.
I think I can only do one.
One is more than none, and that's enough. I'm glad to you guys at home as well. Try go again for 12 reps in total.
Sure.
As you can see with Zoe, she's trying the hardest version of this. It's okay not to go all the way down in the start. If you're struggling to get lower than this, that's fine. I'm still getting the stimulation I need for my chest. I can still get 12 good reps out of this. What you do, ideally want to do at the end of the day is get the goal to be all the way down to the ground, but that takes time, and you've got lots of that, and you've got a lot of movements and opportunities to crush it.
Time and strength.
All right, let's do something a little bit more different. So this is called a bridged stance. Now, a lot of guys will make the excuse of, I don't have a weight at home, I don't have benches at home, so I can't do all the exercises. No. Nature boys,
no excuses.
I've got you covered, of course. So in the bridged position, we're literally going to use our glutes, having our shoulders on the ground, and I'm simply having my stance in this position over here, all right? Now, while my core is engaged, I can grab the dumbbells and do one of two really cool exercises. First one would be a dumbbell fly, so being in the crucifix position, bringing the weight straight back to each other with a straight arm and then down to the ground will give you a beautiful, beautiful chest fly movement. And again, the same thing we can do with the chest press. So elbows down onto the ground and then pressing straight back up, squeezing the pecs together, bringing the weights together, and then repeating that movement all the way down to the ground. So that's two exercises you can do while burning the glutes, getting good stimulation of the core, and getting John Cena ready.
There we go. Well, of course, all the excitement ahead of Fast and the Furious. That's Fast 9. I can't believe the ninth installment.
We've got, nine of them already. I think it clearly tells you why people are so excited for this franchise. We've got more comments coming through while we're doing this workout. People are going crazy. Let's check what they have to say. I see the first one is Rukaya says, that kid from the movie by Baby Driver. I don't know if you remember that. He had the shades on. It was quite a cool one. I think it was like a bank heist or something crazy like that. We've got Susan who says, Liam Neeson will be my go-to guy.
There we go.
Do you remember him on that phone call? I do not want that call. Definitely not. What's the next one, Zoe?
There we go. I have, I'm going to look at Wendy that says Jason Statham, crush. Woo! He can drive me everywhere, anywhere in the world. He's already driving me crazy. Look at that. I'm loving it.
I've seen Jason. The man is absolutely shredded, absolutely ripped. But of course, guys, you can get that too by doing this workout. So get your 12 reps in for each set. 3 sets in total, and you'll be 1 step closer to being John Cena ready. Thank you, Zoe.
Thank you for this. This was
good
cool.
Fun. Yeah.
Thank you.
Ralph's frothing. Ralph's frothing.
He's frothing for it, man. We love it. Pretty intense workout, but that's what you got to do if you want a bod like John Cena. We all love a little bit of me time, maybe curling up on the couch to watch a good movie, but nothing quite beats New Metro extreme cinema style with freshly popped popcorn in hand, watching action-packed adventures on a 3-story ultra HD screen, and then getting pulled into the Dolby Atmos sound and color in a way that you just won't get from home or anywhere else, to be honest.
Now we are continuing counting down the days until Friday when Fast and Furious The Fast Saga will be released in New Metro cinemas nationwide, and we have an inside scoop on the action just for you, because we love you.
Get in.
Who is he?
He's my brother.
What?
Hold on.
Well, that was new. Yeah.
just a scratch. It's fine. It'll be fine. How do they do it, man? Oh, we love it. Absolutely love it. And that's just a snippet of the action that will start from the first second of the film and last until the last second of the film. And New Metro is giving away a set of double New Metro Extreme movie tickets to go and see Fast and Furious 9 plus two regular soda and popcorn combos every day this week.
Wow. Yay. Wow. Wow. Now a very big congratulations to our second winner. Drum rolls in. Marentia Kaster.
Yee-haw. Well done, Marentia.
We asked you to tell us who you will experience Fast and Furious 9 with in hashtag New Metro Extreme. And Marentia said this. She said, most definitely with my husband, Garth Kaster. He's a total car fanatic and watches Fast and Furious 1 to 8 over and over again. We understand why.
Yeah, look, I think he's not alone. I was a latecomer to the kind of franchise, but I went and saw the edition that I did. I think it was like 6 or 7 in an Extreme, and that just kind of just won me over.
We
get
level.
It. Once you, and the beauty of this is they get better and better. The cast gets bigger and stronger.
For sure.
Absolutely amazing.
Mm. For sure. And we hope that you, Marentia, and your husband enjoy the movie. Now, there are still 3 days left to get your hands on a set of those double Extreme F9 tickets and two regular popcorn and soda combos of your own. All you have to do is reply to the competition post on the Expresso Facebook or Twitter page and tell us about your first experience in a New Metro cinema. And don't forget to include the hashtag Expresso New Metro. The competition closes at midday today, so get entering. And remember, those T's and C's can be found on our website, expressoshow.com.
Mm-hmm. And it's worth noting, New Metro cinemas are open Friday to Sunday with all, and I stress, all of the required COVID-19 precautions firmly in place to keep you safe. To go and book your tickets for Fast and the Furious 9, visit newmetro.co.za or call 0861-CINEMA. We'll see you at the movies.
The movies.
It's my feel-good breakfast show.
I promise you that JP Sebastian is back with more movie trailers just for you. And the first one, I'm not even going to try and say the name. Onada? Onada? Onada.
What is happening?
I don't know.
You're having a malfunction.
You're supposed to save me. When I say, then you should say the word is?
Onodach. No, it's not. Onada is a Japanese surname.
Onada.
Yes.
Okay, there we go.
Woohoo! Show's done, folks. Go. So, true story.
This movie is a true story.
Say the bottom part. Oh, darn, it's in English now. The poster was in French.
10,000 nights in the jungle.
Or you could say 10,000 nights, darn, lo song girl. I've offended an entire nation. So, true story about a Japanese soldier who, and this is one of these things that, like, you know, it's like falling into urban legend. People are like, what? Did this really happen? Kind of thing, because it was so bizarre. This guy, after World War II, 1945, the Emperor of Japan surrenders. And he says, war's over, America, you've won. The West, you've won. Whoever else, you've won. But the soldier, Onada, would not believe all the stories, all the pamphlets that were being dropped from the sky saying, dude, come out of the jungle. It is over. 29 years guy spends, or 10,000 nights in the jungle, defending and fighting for a Japan that no longer exists in the way he believes it does. Because the trailer lets on that he's not just like your average soldier. He was raised in, like, you know, intelligence. So he thinks, oh, I'm smarter than the rest of the gang. I was trained to survive. I was told, eat roots, eat bugs, do whatever you have to. But defend this tiny island just off the coast of the Philippines where no one can find you for like 30 years. Because it was about three of them. And then the group started whittling down because gradually dudes were like, I'm
out of here. I feel like
war's over, guys. Like, they were even sending family photos and like messages from family members saying, dude, trust us. It's done. So it looks really remarkably shot and could be great for like the kind of paranoia that I think a lot of people are facing. I wonder how many people aren't going to come out of lockdown, like a bunch of silly billies going like, hey, COVID's over.
Yeah.
Year 2025 or whenever that is. And just...
Now I do feel like the movie needed to be named Onwadach, because it's Onwadach. Why are you staying in the jungle for like 10,000
years? The dudes, like, they ran down from the mountain to try and like, they're going to treat themselves to like fresh cow. So they kill some poor farmer's cow, attached to which was a note saying, come down from the mountain with an exclamation mark. People like,
way to get a message across.
29 years. Anyway.
Anyway.
Looks as tortured as this poor young lady in the...
Wait, is there a movie...
A Date? No, today? Not in South Africa just yet. But by the way, that one and this one that I'm about to talk about now are in line for special selection at the Cannes Film Festival next month, July. So you're going to pronounce this name for me, since you're so good with the French.
Titane.
Titane.
Why did you say French?
What?
Titane.
Titane. If you have a good workout regime, you get... Okay. French for titanium. And the synopsis is totally unhelpful. The French and their movies, the description and the trailer leaves me so, so lost, which is such like a relief.
You leave me lost most of the time, so it's fine.
Lost in my eyes. I don't know why that happened, and I apologize to any person of good conscience watching television. A lady's eaten a serviette, that's what counts. But it looks like totally whacked out, zonked out, Fast and Furious that we're looking at here. Nothing is explained, but it's entrancing. It's encapsulating. The director, Julia, or French surname, which I cannot pronounce, I'm sorry, off the top of my head, but she previously did in 2016 a movie called Raw, which was so good and so visceral, the story about cannibalism, that people fainted in the cinema. So you're in line for another horror movie that isn't like dyed-in-the-wool horror movies. She doesn't make like, this is the spook story, or this is the ghost story, this is the vampire story. It's possibly going to be a coming of age type thing. It's the story where a girl clearly went through some sort of motor vehicle accident and now is strong as titanium as she faces this dude who's pursuing her. Who knows what's going on? It looks as good as anything that like Nicholas Winding Refn has done. Only God forgives. This interesting little niche that she's building for herself. Great new director outcoming in Cannes Film Festival. No date in there, so just yet, but that is Titane or Titan. Titanium. Sorry, guys.
Okay, there's another one, and I can pronounce this. It's called Pig. Yes, Pig. Nicolas Cage is in it. That's all I know.
Okay, so what do you suppose it's about?
I don't know.
Pig is probably a good guess. So Nicolas Cage is such a fascinating creature. What an enigma of a man. Like, there's... Pig. Okay, let's try and start this again because he's that weird. I have to gather my thoughts. Pretty similar to John Wick, it seems by the looks of things. So where you know someone killed a dog. In this case, they kidnapped the pig, and Nicolas Cage loses his mind. Why is the pig so important? Is what you're asking with your face at me right now while you're lost in my eyes.
I'm confused.
Everyone is confused when it comes to Nicolas Cage. He is a truffle farmer or truffle hunter, and what they do is they train pigs to be truffle sniffers. Truffles are like more valuable than gold, pound for pound. So someone kidnaps the pig, obviously they want to make money off the pig, searching for truffles, but they didn't know that Nicolas Cage is a mad person, and so goes on the hunt for who did this to him. Nothing left to lose in his life, secretes himself away in the Oregonian forests, where it's just him and his pig, it's all he's had to love, all he's had to hold, and someone takes everything he values in life, holds dear away from him. Pig, I'm super excited for, because he's such a strange guy. Like, is he doing movies or is he doing Nicolas Cage fanboy movies? Like, this weird overlap where, like, the fanboys will be like, this is an art movie, and the art people will be like, this is a Nicolas Cage movie. What's going on? I think that's next month in South Africa. We'll find out soon enough, but either way, it's weird.
That was weird. That was a lot. That was JP Sebastian. But right now, though, it's the final hour of the show. Here is Zoe with those news headlines.
Thank you, Jamie Lee. I'll start with national headlines. Acting Health Minister Mameluke Mkhubane says the government is looking at opening the COVID-19 vaccine registration portal for people aged 40 years and older. Mkhubane says she had received requests from scores of people worried about the increasing number of COVID-19 infections. She added that her department would like to see the 40-plus registration open within the next few days to make sure people that are active and on the move are vaccinated. Mkhubane said opening up the registration portal would save the country's economy. And staying with local news, President Cyril Ramaphosa yesterday announced that the National Ports Authority is to become an independent subsidiary of the Transnet with its own board. He said the creation of the entity will allow the Port Authority to make its own investment decisions and ensure that it treats all terminal operators fairly and equally. He said this was part of the government's efforts to accelerate economic structural reform. Public Enterprise Minister Pravin Gordhan will appoint the interim board of the new entity by the end of this month. Moving beyond our own borders, in a landmark ruling yesterday, the Abuja-based Economic Community of West African States Court of Justice restrained Nigerian President Muhammadu Buhari's government from prosecuting people for using social media platform Twitter. The ruling comes after a suit filed against the Nigerian government by the Socioeconomic Rights and Accountability Project and 176 concerned Nigerians. The ruling also means that technology companies must immediately restore people's access to social media platform as a human right. And the Vatican confirmed yesterday it had lodged a diplomatic protest against a draft Italian law condemning homophobia. The so-called ZAN law seeks to punish acts of discrimination and incitement to violence against gay, lesbian, transgender and physically challenged people. Since 2013, Pope Francis has adopted a softer tone on homosexuality and has agreed to same-sex couples being granted legal recognition. Nevertheless, the Vatican continues to defend marriage as being between a man and a woman, opposes gay adoptions, and sees gender ideology as a threat to traditional family values. And now for some literary news from our closest northern neighbors. Zimbabwean writer and filmmaker Tsitsi Dangarembga has been awarded a prestigious German prize for a body of work that has made her a prominent African literary voice. Dangarembga, 62, is this year's winner of the Peace Prize of the German Book Trade, which is endowed with $29,700. That's some 424,000 rand. She will receive it in Frankfurt, Germany on October 24th. The judges said that she, at first look, she is the first black woman to win the prize, and I quote, not just one of her country's most important artists, but also a widely audible voice of Africa in contemporary literature. They also pointed to her commitment of promoting culture in her country and opening it up for women, and to her fight for rights and political change in Zimbabwe. Her work includes the best-selling novel Nervous Conditions and its sequel The Mournable Body. Last July, Dangarembga was arrested and spent a night in detention for standing alongside a road in Zimbabwean capital Harare, holding a placard with the wording, "We want better, reform our institutions." She has this year also been awarded the Pen Pinter Prize and the Pen International Award for Freedom of Expression. Well, on that note, that's where I leave your morning headlines. Here's a final look at your sport with Graham.
Thanks, so let's start with cricket. India lead New Zealand by 32 runs with 8 wickets still remaining as they go into the reserve sixth day of that World Test Championship final at the Ajaccio Bowl in Southampton today. Tim Southee, he picked up the wickets of both Indian openers as they finished on 64 for 2 in their second innings at stumps. Earlier in the day, New Zealand turned their overnight result of 101 for 2 into 249 all out. The World Test Championship final will continue from 11:30 a.m. SA time today. Then on to football, the 12th minute header from close range by Manchester City forward Raheem Sterling secured a 1-0 win for England against the Czech Republic and also confirmed their place in the Euro 2020 last 16. So England finished at the top of Group D with 7 points. Other results from last night, Croatia recorded a 3-1 victory over Scotland in Glasgow thanks to goals by midfielders Nikola Vlasic, Luka Modric and Ivan Perisic. There'll be 4 Euro 2020 fixtures today and a massive one as defending European champions Portugal will face world champions France in a must-see encounter that kicks off at 9 p.m. Well, still on the topic, Wembley Stadium in London will now accommodate more than 60,000 spectators for the semi-finals and the finals of Euro 2020. This has been confirmed by the UK government. This increase will see the largest crowds gather for a sports event in the United Kingdom for more than 15 months now. The Euro 2020 semi-finals will take place on the 6th and 7th of July, with that final being played on the 11th of next month. That's a wrap of your sport for this Wednesday morning. Let's get one last look at what the weather has in store and some crazy global weather warnings as well.
And we'll start with that crazy global warnings for you guys. Now, a devastating mouse plague caused by a combination of ideal weather conditions is ravaging some parts of Australia, especially New South Wales. Ideal conditions for breeding and a bountiful harvest that followed destructive bushfires and a prolonged drought in the spring of 2020 have caused the worst mouse plague in many decades. Now, with plenty of grain to feed on and diminished populations of predators that perished during the drought, mice have flourished. Now, there have been reports of infestations at schools, hospitals, supermarkets, and family homes. A jail is being forced to relocate hundreds of inmates while it carries out cleaning and renovations. And more than 400 prisoners and 200 staff at the Wellington Correctional Centre will be moved to other facilities as the mice have caused extensive damage to prison infrastructure, including internal wiring and ceiling panels. Now, the plague has hit farmers particularly hard, though, as they grapple with the cost of pest control and the destruction of crops. And then while we enjoy experiencing a sunrise from your part of South Africa, we do have some international viewers tuning in on both YouTube and the Africa channel in the USA. And we remain down under for your international weather update as we head to the harbour city of Newcastle. Now, Newcastle is the second most populated area in the state of New South Wales and is located at the mouth of the Hunter River. Now, it is famous for its coal. Newcastle is the largest coal exporting harbour in the world. Its plentiful beaches are linked by the Bathers Way, a coastal walk stretching between Nobby's Beach and Muirwether Beach. Today, however, will be a rather cloudy day in the area, reaching a maximum of 18 degrees Celsius. And then coming back to our local viewer contributions, we received these beautiful sunrise photos that we featured this morning. And we started the morning with this beautiful view of the sun rising through the trees from Anthea Langefeld from Ottery. Another one came through from a regular contributor, Fatah Khan from Richards Bay, who shared the serene image overlooking the ocean in the bay. Monique van Rensburg from Gqeberha also shared this beautiful skyline, showing off some views of blue, pink, and yellow. And then last but definitely not least, another regular contributor, Ntokozo Theo Makatini from Johannesburg, shared another great photo with us showing off the clouds illuminated by the moon still in the sky as it transitions from night to day. And again, if you would like to share your sunrise photo with us, head on over to the Expresso Facebook page, and who knows, you might get a young feature here on your Feel Good Breakfast Show. Right now, though, it's time to have a final look at the temperatures for you, South Africa. We start with you, Polokwane, do expect a low of 6 today, peaking at 21. If you're out and about in Umbombela, expect a range of 11 to 29. Pretoria, for you, it is a low of 7, peaking at 19. And then Johannesburg, coming through with a minimum of 6, peaking at 17. Mahikeng, 421. Klerksdorp, for you, it is 320. And then Kimberley ranges from 6 to 22 today. Bloemfontein ranges from 1 to 20. And then the Bay, Richards Bay, with a minimum of 11, peaking at 25. Pietermaritzburg, for you, it is 7.25. And then Durban ranges from 17 to 26 as well, as well as Mthatha with a minimum of 11 and a maximum of 25. East London ranges from 14 to 22. And if you do find yourself in Craddock today, expect a low of 7 and a high of 23. Gqeberha, for you, it is 10.19. George following with a low of 10 and a high of 18. But if you do find yourself in the mother city, Cape Town, today, you can expect a 59% chance of rain with a low of 10 and a high of 15. Worcester, 7.15. Sutherland, 1.12. And then last but definitely not least, Upington ranges from 6 to 24 today. That was your weather here on your Feel Good Breakfast Show, but keep it locked right here.
Super excited. In just a moment, I'm going to be catching up with front Counting Crows frontman Adam Duritz.
Oh, yay. And we've got some chicken stew coming up. Chef La Bumbo's in the building. Let's check it. We'll see you soon.
That's all that's good. It's my feel-good breakfast show. Right. Deep breath.
Would you like to take another deep breath?
I'm going
to
have a little bit of a moment here. Please bear with me. This is one of those kind of highlight moments for me in my career. Exploding onto the music scene with their multi-platinum breakout album, August and Everything After, back in 1993, the timeless rock and roll band Counting Crows has kept audiences and fans, including myself, absolutely enchanted over nearly 30 years with 7 immaculate studio albums. It's been feeling like a long December since they last released music 7 years ago, and listeners have been falling accidentally in love with their highly anticipated latest EP, Butter Miracle Sweet One. Now, we have the greatest pleasure and honor to be joined right now by Counting Crows frontman Adam Duritz via video call all the way from what looks like the most idyllic setting right in London. Let's give him a warm espresso welcome. Good morning.
Come on, Adam. Adam, it's so good to see you. It's so wonderful to be able to connect with you in this way. What have you and the band been up to over the past 7 year hiatus? And you know, what impact did this global COVID-19 lockdown have on your creative process?
We had been touring all the way up till 2019.
I was actually over here in England. I'm on a farm in the west of England right now. I just wanted to start playing piano and writing again. So I rented a keyboard, and a friend drove it down from London. And, you know, a couple days later, I had written the Tall Grass, the first song on the EP. And as I was finishing writing it, I started singing this other piece of music, and I realized, at first I thought it was just an extension on that song, and then I realized, oh no, this is a whole different song. What if I wrote a series of songs where the end of one was the beginning of the other? And that got me very excited, and I wrote this whole suite of music. We were about 85% done with the record when the quarantines hit, so we had to finish it a little while later. So most of the pandemic was actually spent waiting to release the record, really. One of the things with me is that once I start writing, I want to write a whole record, I want to record it, and I want to put it out. And I think I avoided writing songs because I know that. I wanted to avoid putting out a record for a little bit, and I know once I get started, there's no stopping.
And what would you say this music that you are putting out now sort of signifies about your career and where you're at today compared to all of those many years ago? I mean, of course, a buildup of so many, many years, but there must be a different approach and a different way that you're wanting to tell messages now.
I don't know. It all kind of comes from, you know, whatever weird, twisted thing it is about being a musician where you decide you can take your life and rhyme it, and then just suddenly start singing songs. Whatever weird thing it is that makes us want to turn our lives into songs, I don't think it ever really changes. I mean, you change, and the songs change, but for whatever reason, some of us are born with this bizarre motivation. Everyone else seems to get through life perfectly well without rhyming. but for some reason, it's just something we're born with.
And then it's just an added bonus that your rhymes make people cry, because you've always been able to do that. There is the ability to capture an emotional kind of connection through your music that is unparalleled, let's be honest, in the industry, which is something that I think you really must be proud of. On the flip side of that, obviously you said you were just waiting during quarantine to be able to complete the project, and it looked like, judging by your Instagram, that you spent a fair bit of that time cooking some pretty mouth-watering dishes. Have you always been a foodie? What led to that sense of expression? Why take to the gram to share your love of cooking?
Well, I mean, about a month and a half into the quarantines, I was sitting around one day and I said to my girlfriend that I was really worried I'm going to wake up a year and a half from now and I'll have just done nothing. And I don't want to do that. I think I'm going to, you know, I've always cooked, but I said, I'm going to try and learn to cook everything. I'm going to just cook all the time for us. And I started just like cooking every night. A few months later, I started throwing some of it up on our Instagram stories. And then she suggested I like to film them a little better and do it on Instagram TV. So I started doing that. And I was already cooking a lot. And I thought I had to learn to sort of film it after that. But the weird thing was that it caught on. Like, so many people got interested in it. That really surprised me.
It surprised all of us.
I started getting offers to do cooking shows.
Totally surprised all of us, and we've enjoyed seeing the food that you've cooked. But now, I think any person going on now to try and see what you've been up to and just searching on the internet right now, they will find it's quite amusing to find that the third most searched term for you on Google is Adam Durrett's girlfriends. Not one, but girlfriends. But you've dated some incredibly famous people over the years. You know, we'd like to play a quick game where maybe you can describe each of the following people with one word. No explanation needed. Graham will give you the name.
Okay.
And then look, I'm sorry
we're doing this to you, but we couldn't resist. And I'm hoping you're going to be very honest with us. So I just need one word from you, my friend, to encapsulate this person. We know her, we love her. Courtney Cox.
There is not a chance I'm doing this.
Come on! Should we maybe try a different name? Maybe you'd like to pass on that one. Should we try this one? Mary Louise Parker.
Oh, she's my best friend. We've been friends since we were, I don't know how long ago. We've known each other for 30 plus years. She's one of my best friends. I mean, she's like my sister. We were born a day apart. To this day, she's very close friends with my girlfriend. ML is like my sister. And don't think we've ever actually dated. But we went on one date when we first met, actually, whatever that was, 40 years ago.
I love that. We're going to throw one more in here just to make you really uncomfortable. Jennifer Aniston.
Oh, really nice girl. Really nice girl.
Yeah. Well, look, the list is long, so we'll just leave
it there. I'm incapable, apparently, of giving a one-word answer.
Yeah. No, we'll
Nobody,
just leave
trust me. You can take it up with your management team. They suggested we have a little bit of fun with you, and you've been game, my friend. Lastly, I've got to ask, because we love you, man, and I love you, dude, and this has really been a special moment for me. What's next for you guys after these three remarkable decades of incredible accomplishments and what you've given to the industry and what you've given to your fans? Are we going to see more music being created, a full-length album? Now that you've got a bite of the crazy creative rhyming process again, do you think we're going to see more of it?
Well, I've got the keyboard set up in the other room again, so I'm going to try and write a second suite while I'm here. That's one of the reasons I wanted to come over here.
Adam, you're a legend, my friend. Thank you for giving me so many amazing moments as a fan listening to the unbelievable music that you produced over the years. It really has been a pleasure connecting with you, and thanks for having a little bit of fun with us this morning. You're a legend, man.
Thanks, you guys. I really appreciate it.
Oh, gee, what a man. What a guy. What a legend. What an icon. Now, listen, take a listen to this very carefully crafted and familiar sounds of Counting Crows, their latest work, Butter Miracle Suite 1. You're going to be transported to a classic era of
rock and roll, baby.
Oh, thank you, gents. You know what? When the weather is stormy and cold, I can just think of hearty comfort food because that really is one of my favorites. And we are here to show you a classic chicken stew that absolutely sounds perfect for right about now. So this aromatic, flavorful meal, it is the perfect winter warmer. And we have Chef Labumbu to show us how to put it together. Welcome to Expresso.
How are you?
Oh, I like that. Yes, we need some sound effects when we introduce you, Chef.
Definitely. Aww.
Now, you mentioned you are from Limpopo.
Yes,
where did
I
your
am.
Love for food come from?
My grandmother taught me how to cook from
okay.
a very young age, so she practically raised me.
Aww.
So I'm from a place called Waterval.
Waterval.
Yeah.
Who is your Afrikaans?
Well, sorry, I don't know how to speak Afrikaans.
I just assume because you're in Waterval.
No.
You know what that is in English?
Is it you are waterfall?
Waterfall.
Yeah, I do know.
Okay, so Chef, what are you starting us off with?
I'm starting with the classic Maggie spread.
There we go. We've got our clover classic. It's great for spreads.
Yep.
It's great for baking. It's great for cooking, like our chef is doing. So you're adding some of our clover classic fast spread.
Yep.
And then you're about to brown your onion.
Thank you very much.
There we go. Is stew something you cook often?
This is actually, when I started by cooking tin fish, right?
Really?
And then the second time my friend taught me how to cook chicken stew.
Okay.
Because my grandmother wasn't around.
Oh, that's special that your friend got to teach you. So I grew up eating stews. I think out of the weeknight, we had stews four nights out of the week.
Is it?
So my mom is a big stew maker. She forgot to teach me how to make it. So I'm here to learn from you.
You know what?
Shame, she didn't forget. I just wasn't at the time interested, and now I regret it.
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So I'm assuming you got lots of cooking tips from your grandma?
Yeah, definitely. And I also, thank my sister for polishing everything for me.
Oh,
that was great.
But that's the beauty of a stew. You get to really just make it your own.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Mm. Definitely.
Okay. So, Chef, what have we got going there? You've got the onions in there.
Yep. And I've got a little bit of garlic in here.
Ooh.
And also, can you please chop a little bit of green pepper?
Let me get busy. And you know, I'm that person in the kitchen. I just yap away with a cup of coffee in my hands. There we go. Okay.
Yes.
And then, Chef,
mm-hmm.
How long have you been in the cooking industry?
Let's just say I've been in the cooking industry since 2018.
Okay,
yep.
Okay.
And then 2019, that's when I owned my own restaurant.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah. It was a hell of a year, but I really enjoyed it. I learned a lot. I learned from my employees as well.
Oh,
because
amazing.
Because I didn't go to culinary school.
Oh, so it was a self-taught. Oh, amazing.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? That is where home cooking comes from, and this is the stew we are making today.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I'm very excited to see what you're going to add next. What mm-hmm. is that?
This is, I'm adding some spices
Ooh,
in here.
Oh, there we go.
A little bit of herbs.
There we go.
Mixed herbs and paprika.
Oh, Is this, are you more of a spicy man or a flavor man?
I'm more of a flavor man.
Flavor,
I'm a South African chef. Most people are French chefs, but I want to, this is what I want to achieve. I want the South African taste all the damn time.
Yes, yes, all the time.
All the time. I've got my own recipes, my own food, you know, that I've started from scratch.
Okay.
Like the bombastic bun. Everything is bombastic.
Bombastic. Mr. Bombastic. There
Never
we
trust
go.
A skinny chef.
Never trust a skinny chef. Yes, I've heard that before. I've heard that
can
before.
Can you smell that?
I can get the different aromas, and this is what a stew does. You walk in the drive. In fact, you enter the driveway and you can already smell the food. Now, chef, I know a stew is something that takes time.
Mm-hmm.
We are unfortunately pressed for time.
No problem.
So how long would that stew normally take?
It'll take about 30 to 40 minutes.
30 to 40 minutes. And then is the secret to cook it as slow as possible?
Please.
Okay.
Please.
Okay. Because you want the meat nice and soft, right?
Exactly. You don't want any blood or anything.
Okay. So we've got our spices in. We've got our onions in. You've got our garlic in. What are we adding next?
Now we're just adding tomatoes.
There we go. Of course, we have this recipe for you. You can find it on our website. That's expressoshow.com.
Mm-hmm.
Chef Labombo is showing us some amazing tricks. What are you adding there now? Some
it's a tomato paste.
Tomato paste.
Also, I forgot. Just give me my green peppers, please.
Oh, yes. I'm still chopping.
Thank you so much.
There we go. Oh, yes. You have to add peppers.
Cook in here.
If you need more, I'm busy chopping here.
No, no. That's fine. I'll be okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Yep.
There we go. And then, which veggies, I'm assuming, when do you add the carrots?
I'm going to add them right after the green peppers have cooked just a little bit.
A little bit more.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
And, you know, and then after, I'm just going to add my chicken stock. It's important to add the chicken stock.
Okay.
It must taste like chicken. It mustn't taste like anything else.
I know, and I think that's going to be the secret to getting our warm, hearty chicken stew.
Definitely.
Chef, I'm loving this. So you've got that going. I know we are running out of time right now.
Yep.
You're going to add the chicken, then the chicken stock, and then the carrots. Is that the step?
That's no, you add the carrots. Then the chicken and the chicken stock.
Okay, so we go in that order.
Thank you.
Chef Labombo is his first time on your Feel Good Breakfast show. He brought us that bombastic flavor. And if you would love to get your hands on this amazing chicken stew recipe, make sure you head on over to our website. That's expressoshow.com. And if you've missed any of the steps, here's a recap for you.
Classic fashion from Tembi, classic cars, thanks Chad, and we've seen classic hairstyles, and you Michael? Classic!
A classic range from Clover, timeless taste.
Made with love by Clover.
If you eat, sleep, and dream of baking, enter for the Tastemaster SA's new season starting in August on SABC2. Grow your career in TV and as a baking influencer and stand to win 50,000 rands worth of prizes. To apply to compete on the show, share a video of you baking a wonder you've created with tried and trusted Royal Baking Powder. Upload your video and complete your application on the tastemaster.co.za website. Entries close Wednesday, 7th July. T's and C's apply.
It's my feel good breakfast show.
Welcome back, everybody. This is your Feel Good Breakfast Show. Time for some fun and games. But before you head off to work this morning, why not take just 5 minutes to sit down, drink your coffee, and watch the beautiful Zoe Brown and the Music Man after our very own hearts, Majozi, in another round of the five-second game. Today, I'm switching it up. I'm making it all about animals. Ooh. I know you have Navy. Do you have any animals?
No, sadly not.
No?
Not yet.
But this is going to prepare you for that, okay? So, Zoe, I'm going to start with you first.
Okay.
Giving Majozi, you know. You've played this before. We played this with you on Zoom. You've won.
Yes, I won, and I didn't get my Omahas. I didn't get any.
We'll make sure you leave with a box.
Thank you very
much. Definitely. So, are you ready?
I am ready. So, whatever you give me animal-related, I have 5 seconds to answer.
That is it. Zoe, name three animals with a tail.
Cats, dogs, rats. Ooh. I don't know why I said rat. I'm just thinking of a rat.
But straight to the point, I love it. Majozi, for you, name three animals that can fly.
Bird, pterodactyl. Bat.
What was the second one you said?
Pterodactyl.
A what?
A pterodactyl. It's a dinosaur.
It doesn't exist anymore.
Extinct. Doesn't matter. We'll still give it to you. But he's a very pterodactyl. Okay. Back to you, Z. Name three animals that start with the letter B.
Bears, bugs,
baboons.
G helped you with that one in the background. That's
minus
unfair.
Points. Minus
no, it's not my
minus
fault.
Points. Minus points.
G, be quiet, please. Yeah, right? But Josie, name three animals that are carnivores.
Lions, cheetahs, and hyenas.
There we go.
Why are you looking so skeptical?
No, because the way you said lions and cheetahs, I was like, liars and cheetahs.
Next round. Name three famous animal cartoons, Zoe.
Donald Duck, Minnie Mouse, Mickey Mouse.
Oh, you're on it today. Wow. You are on the bun. She wants this. She really wants this.
She definitely had
Ariel, the Little Mermaid. But Josie, for you, name three animals found on the South African rand.
Oh, buffalo, a sheep, and
no, there's not a sheep on our money.
There's a sheep
money
on the tin rand, isn't there? On the back of the
isn't
tin rand.
A goat?
Is there no sheep anywhere?
Who has a 10 rand? Does anybody have money?
This is an agricultural thing.
Just shows when last we had money
in our wallets. It just shows you we're in the digital age. We don't carry money on us anymore.
You've seen a sheep. Thank you. Yeah, I've seen a sheep.
Okay, so G and you are the only people in South Africa that's seen a sheep on the rand?
Yes.
Okay.
Studied it.
We'll give it to you.
Yeah.
We'll give it to you. Zoe, this is easy for you. Name three types of cats.
Oh my gosh. They're just cats. They're domestic cats.
Come on, I thought you were gonna like own this round.
Wow. I know my animals, I don't know my types.
There's Navy, there's something. Okay, Majozi.
I just like black cats.
Majozi, name three types of dogs.
A Wolverine, sausage dog, Dalmatian.
Yes.
It's like a nice, pretty dog. It's got like a grey coat normally, like very silky coat.
Is this true?
Coat.
I don't even know. See, you don't know your types.
I'm probably pronouncing it incorrectly. Wolverine, something like that. I don't know.
Very fancy dog.
Yeah. I love
it. It's your accent. Just blame the accent.
I've never heard of it.
Last round, I think it's probably a tie at this point.
This is a tiebreaker.
I'm thrashing Zoe.
Winner. Yes.
Please count correctly.
Okay.
This is your chance, Zoe, to maybe tie. Maybe.
I am with a domestic cat. Domestic cat. Zoe, name three farm animal sounds.
Oh, meh, woof, quack. Why are you doing this to me?
We needed to see that again. Meh.
That was a sheep.
Sheep from the tin.
Yeah, it's found on the tin
rand, in the back of the tin rand, yeah. That's great.
Last one to you, Majozi. Give me three different types of roars.
Three different types of
We just wanted the variety of your voice. I think you can do a better one. Do it in like a...
Is this a baby?
Mm-hmm. There's a big one.
That's a T-Rex. That's
and
a
then
T-Rex.
A shy one, maybe like a shy one. I feel like that's on the same one.
I think he deserves to win.
I think because of that, we are going to give you your Oma box.
Well done.
Over there, just because you are the winner. Look
Thank
at that smile.
Much. Thank you. Since the age of three, I've been eating Omar rice. Thank you, Omar, wherever you are.
You deserve it, Majozi. And of course, if you want to sound like a winner, then there is a brand new chance for you to win that Omar hamper and a 1,000 rand cash prize. Now, to enter, we want you to share your best memory with Omar rice. Now, share your stories with us on the competition post on the Expresso Facebook or Twitter page and use the hashtag dipping time in your answer. And remember, every entry also guarantees you a spot in the lucky draw for the Smeg hamper worth 12,000 Rand. Now, for all the T's and C's, you can visit the website expressoshow.com. Good luck to all of you. Yeah, thank you. I'm taking
it from you. No, get back.
Anytime is dipping time when it's with the ones you love.
All right, so we're not going to continue with any more animal noises, but we're all going to give you some beautiful sounds, right? And that's coming from an exceptional voice and an even more exceptional guitar. Now, we're back on the stage with Majozi, and he had us tapping our toes all through the summer with this next single he's going to perform, and it's all about patience, it's all about compassion, and it's all about love. And I'm talking about the song titled Falling. Yeah, he is, Majozi, with that beautiful soundtrack.
Come rolling in, you know the sun will shine again. When it gets dark and you can't find the answer, every time you need a friend, you know I'll be there till the end. And when the lights go down, we'll dance together. So lay your head next to mine, maybe I could ease your mind. You to realize that I'm right here with you. When the stars are falling from the sky and your days turn into endless nights, no, I'll always be there by your side. So don't go giving up, because I'll be there when the sky is falling, do, 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 falling, do, 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 falling, do, 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 and I'll be there when the sky is falling. I'll pick you up straight off the floor, carry you through every door, I'll make you smile, I'll never let that vanish. Cause you're the one that I adore. Mi solito, mi amor. Don't ask me why I'm still so bad at Spanish. So lift your head to the sun. You and I've just begun. Our love will never come undone. Cause I'm right here with you. When the stars are falling from the skies and your days turn into endless nights, no, I'll always be there by your side. So don't go giving up, because I'll be there when the sky is falling. When you can't breathe and it's not easy, please believe. Stars are falling from the skies. your days turn into endless nights. No, I'll always be there by your side. So don't go giving up, 'cause I'll be there when the sky is falling. So don't go giving up, because I'll be there when the sky is falling.
Nourish your skin with Ingram's for Men, enriched with triple glycerine for 48-hour moisture and no stickiness. Ingram's, your skin, your brave.
It's my feel-good breakfast show.
Welcome back, beautiful souls. And now we're talking about something magic. And Koo, who are looking for Mzansi's next best cooking star, who enjoys creating nourishing and balanced meals. Now, Tabiso meets up with Adley Reddy and Arthur Ramaroko to discover the Koo products journey from farm to plate. Let's check it out.
Farming is one of South Africa's most vital sectors. It boosts the economy and feeds the nation. But have you ever wondered how your food goes from farm to plate? Well, the brand new TV show Colour Your Plate with Koo plans to showcase just that, and also how you can create some delicious and nutritious meals with Koo. I'm meeting with Koo brand manager Adley Reddy and Koo nutritionist Arthur Ramaroka to tell us all about the show. I always wonder where big brands like Koo get their fruit and veg. So explain it to me, please. How does it work, and where and how does Koo farm?
Well, being one of South Africa's favorite brands, we have our roots planted firmly in Mzansi. Our fruit and veg is grown right here at home.
So essentially, Koo supports local farmers.
Yes, we have farms across the country, from our fruit farms in the Western Cape to our vegetable farms in Limpopo.
It's all about local farmers and being proudly South African, which is fantastic. How does it benefit the people?
It's really simple. To get the wholesome benefits of fruit and vegetables, it just starts by getting a jar or a can of Koo and start your five-a-day journey.
Arthur, you're the nutritional expert on Colour Your Plate with Koo. What are you going to be looking out for?
I'm looking for balance and colour in the plate, and make sure that what you serve, half of it is vegetables. And most importantly, don't forget to add your own flavour.
Okay, so if I think I've got what it takes, how do I enter Colour Your Plate with Koo?
Tabiso, it's really easy. Buy any three Koo products and create a colourful dish and take a picture of that and send it via WhatsApp with the phrase Koo 5 a day. And you could become Mzansi's next cooking star.
It seems like anyone can plate a delicious, colourful and wholesome meal when they cook with Koo. Just show us your colourful plate and you could be Mzansi's next cooking star.
She's salivating here.
I know. I'm looking at that and it is beautiful, looking at that produce. I mean, I want to colour my plate with Koo.
I know. And how could you go wrong with the classic? You've got beans, you've got sweet corn. I mean, we're talking about such nostalgic moments as well.
There we go.
Daily food stuff.
There we go. And if you need a reminder on how to enter this competition to win awesome prizes, look at this.
A healthier you starts with you and your plate. Join us on a nourishing journey by entering to be on SABC2's new show, Colour Your Plate with Koo. To be part of the show, buy any three Koo products and send Koo 5 a day to 072 741 5357 on WhatsApp. Follow the steps to load a picture of your colourful meal served and stand to win prizes valued at 500,000 rands with Koo. Koo, uzogcwala.
So when the temperature drops, we crave wholesome comfort food from soups and stews like a broccoli and cheddar soup, or maybe a Mediterranean beef stew, and even desserts like malva puddings and apple crumble cake. Now that I've got you completely salivating. With an Instant Pot, there is a never-ending list of hearty winter warmer dinner ideas that the whole family will definitely enjoy. And today, you are in for a treat because Miriam from Cooked Inc., an Instant Pot expert, is here to cook everybody's favorite, her speciality, Instant Pot lamb curry and rice. The magic happens in this pot in less than an hour, and it is so easy.
It's very easy.
It's so easy that I can even help this morning. I'm going to help with the rice this morning.
Good morning, everybody.
So good to have you here. Thank you for bringing me this delightful breakfast. I'm going to tuck in just a moment. I understand your son also likes this food.
Yes, my son, my six-year-old, loves curry for breakfast. He'll come in and he's like, Mama, can I have some curry, please, for breakfast?
So, and, well, that's the one advantage of having a mama like you, girl. That's the way it works. Okay, so obviously the game changes when we're using Instant Pot because it does become really simple.
Easy. So I call it the hands-free pot.
Aha, I like
because
that.
Because a lot of people think it's instant, like it's happening right now. But for me, it's more about that I can put my food in and I can leave. Mm. I can sit and do bath time in the evening. I can go to the gym. I can prepare other things, sit and do homework, all of this other stuff, which a normal pot, you have to keep on going back to check up and like add a little bit of
phases,
water.
Phases,
and,
for sure.
And it burns and things like that.
And also the end result's going to be spectacular because this is going to cook the meat in a very special way.
So soft. So soft.
Okay, so let's get
right, let's
what
get
do we need
started. So first we are going to switch our pot onto saute mode.
Okay.
Okay. Your saute mode has three temperatures. So a slow, right, and then a medium, and then a high heat.
Okay.
Okay, so I like to preheat my pot first.
Okay.
So while I'm getting all my ingredients ready, I have my pot going already.
Kind of, so it's ready to rock and roll once you get there, cool.
Right, so while that is heating up, I have my rice over here.
Okay, we've washed the rice.
We've washed the rice. I like to just add some water to it, okay? Just to get it pre-soaking while that is heating up.
Okay.
Okay, so we just get that going. And we're going to drain that. When we are cooking basmati rice, you always want to rinse it properly, okay? And you're always using a 1:1 ratio.
Okay.
So 1 cup of rice to 1 cup of water.
Okay. Right. You rinse it to remove some of the starch.
Yes. Right? Okay. So get nice, loose, fluffy grains.
Beautiful. Cool.
Okay. Over here, I've got my lamb. I've got 1 kilo of lamb. So when you're cooking, so this is nice small pieces of lamb that we have over here, which will even reduce our time even more.
Okay.
So instead of going for a 25 minutes today, we can even go for a 20 minutes.
Okay.
Right, because so the smaller the pieces, the less time it's going to take.
It's going to need, okay, that stands to reason.
So I'm just going to wait for my pot.
That being said, you know, the bigger pieces on the bone, there's something delicious about the fat rendering off the bone and the marrow and
that's
that, you know?
Like food on the bone, protein on the bone is still the best for me. Because you're getting
flavor.
All that goodness and that flavor and things that comes out of the bone.
Okay.
So I have 1 chopped onion going in.
Cool.
And we're just going to saute that for a bit.
Okay.
Okay. Right. I'm going to turn my temperature a bit higher. So you can see there, it goes less, normal, and more.
Okay, cool.
And while that is going there, I'm going to take my rice.
Is that a patented finger stir?
I'm just going to drain it a little.
Yeah, you can see the starch coming off there as well, yeah.
Okay. My rice is going in. If you wanted to flavor this rice, you could add some cumin, roast it off with a little bit of butter. Right, season your rice nicely. Right, so we're going to add in our water. Do you want to add it in? I'll tell you when to stop.
Go for it.
And stop.
Ha ha! The salt?
Yes, you always season your rice at the beginning and never at the end.
Just a pinch or how much?
A generous pinch.
A generous pinch. What's that?
A little bit more.
What's that? Gonna do it with the sound effect.
There we go. Right, so we're gonna put our lid on.
Okay.
Why don't you?
I'm.
Now you're going to break it. Right, so there. That way down. Okay.
Oh, and it sings to
and
you
it
even.
It sings to you even.
Let you know.
Right, and you close it.
Easy peasy. Okay.
Easy peasy. So cool. Now we go to the pressure cook button here on the front. Right. I can't work upside down.
I love the fact that it makes it so explanatory. Like, yeah. You know, it lists the different things that you can cook in it, but the fact that you can take it to the pressure cook elements, that for me, because you know it's going to cook a lot faster, it's amazing. This is like a spaceship cooking pot.
For 10 minutes, so and cool. Now we walk away. So it has lovely presets also. So for the beginner, it's quite nice to have.
You can ease into it. Yeah.
Just to ease into it. So there's a soup button, there's a rice button, and everything is preset. Right, so our onions, you can hear, starting to sizzle.
Okay, we've got about a minute to finish this, guy. Wow. So let's do it. I know.
In goes our tomato.
When we say quick and easy, we mean it, eh?
Right, in goes my garlic. My ginger. Oh my,
I like the fact
spices.
So you can actually get a nice, a really good saute going before
you
kind of add the lid.
Yes, and you just want to roast that spices off a bit.
So that's vital with the curry, it's kind of activating the flavors in the spices first, huh? Oh, that smells amazing.
Starting to smell like curry. In goes my lamb.
You can find this recipe on expressoshow.com.
And there's my potato.
With all of our culinary inspiration. And again, smaller cubes of potato means cook.
Yeah.
Cook
so we can cook it all even. Right. Just deglaze my pot.
Ah, so there we go. All that flavor transfers to the meat and the.
Can you pass me on some water? I need a half a cup, please. You go for
that. Tell me when.
Stop. That's enough.
Cool.
Now we press cancel. We going pressure cook, and what did I say? How many minutes? Let's see if you were listening.
25.
Now we're reducing it to 20 minutes.
20, because we've got smaller bits of lamb. Perfect. I love the fact that you can enter as a beginner, and it's really easy. Or as someone who's spent a bit of time really kind of delving into the multitude of uses here, you can get quite nuanced with how you cook with the device as well.
So
absolutely
do
beautiful.
Yogurt, all of that stuff in here.
Oh, superb. Thank you so much. You were the right person to make my introduction, and I want you guys at home to listen up because you stand the chance of winning big this morning. If you'd like to get your hands on an Instant Pot Duo crisp and air fryer to the value of 4,999 Rand, you have to reply to the competition post on our Expresso Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram pages and tell us why you would like an Instant Pot Duo crisp and what the first dish you'd make in it is. And don't forget to use that hashtag Instant Pot SA. Competition closes on Friday the 25th of June at midday. T's and C's can be found as always on expressoshow.com. As I say goodbye to you, I'm going to wander past you and I'm going to have a little taste of the end result, yeah? Because this looks absolutely beautiful. And again, you can find this at expressoshow.com. Oh, goodness. If a cozy winter blanket brings a glow to your face, it's a lifesaver for children and families in need. So partner with us and Game to help Gift of the Givers and the Homestead Project for Street Children wrap a new blanket around every cold set of shoulders that we can. Donate to any new blanket in collection boxes at select Game stores nationwide up until the end of June. And obviously with COVID-19 regulations meaning only new ones are accepted, each blanket is going to be a treasure to someone.
Off an incredible morning with singer and songwriter Majozi, and he's taking the Expresso stage one more time to perform his latest single called Close to You. Close to you, everybody.
I love the way that we fit together, keeping close in this Jersey weather. The way you fell into my arms is as if it's by design. I always knew when we met each other, I
really wish you could meet my mother, 'cause I know you'd steal her heart as fast as you stolen mine. Who knew you'd come along and make falling in love easy? Oh, oh, I pray that someday I'd see the light, then I saw you. You dance so crazy, trying to move like an insta baby. And every time I fly away, it hurts me to say goodbye. I really wish I could be much better and take away all the storms you've weathered. But I know you're covered by the love of the one on high.